Shalom, greetings to all and all. Selamta, Inest Lin. This is Ras Alonso Tafar reporting for the Lion of the Tribe of Judah Society of His Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie I, and His Christ Jesus, HaMashiach, Yeshua. For the record, this day is Sunday, May 28th, and 2017, and it is 11:35 a.m. Now the following work that we are to present, we do or we bring forth on the basis that to do what we can is to do what we must. If one can perform it better, then by all means, feel free to do so. Now, a few key points, disclaimers, not really, but you know, something of that nature. The following text that we are to read, we must make mention that the names in Amharic, the Amharic names, the pronunciation of them cannot be assured that we will do it as accurately as it would have been possible if the names would have been provided for in the Amharic text or in the Amharic language. That is, we do not know the vowel system, the pointing on the vowel system that is utilized, which includes the English alphabet. And so we are sure that the pronunciation of Amharic names will not be precise and exact. So let this be a warning to the listener. And to continue, we make mention that we are not professional readers. As a matter of fact, we did not begin to read up until the age of possibly 25, and we are now 30, and that is because we were called to Rastafari. We were called to Christ in light of Rastafari. Until that time, we had no interest in reading. To add to this, we learned to speak and speak mostly Spanish our whole lives to this very day. Therefore, you know, if ones could do it better, by all means, bring it forth. And I just do what we can, and that is to do what we must. Wednesday, May 31st, 2017, Chapter 13, about our pressing for Ethiopia's entry into the League of Nations. When the Great World War was over, it was feared that a similarly dreadful war might break out again in future. Therefore, if a League of Nations having been established, a quarrel arose between two governments, the willful waging of war having ceased, the matter about which the quarrel occurred would come before the League. After investigation, judgment would be given by the vote of the League. It having become manifest, in accordance with the importance of the conflict, that a certain government had given offense, while another government had been the victim of that offense. On 20th Sinai, 1911, which is to say 21st June 1919, 27 governments had reached agreement and signed the treaty, concurring that it was improper for a strong government willfully to attack a weak one or to impose financial sanctions on it, but that if a government transgressed the wishes of the League, it would be the opponent of the entire assembly, and they were all to rise up against it in opposition. The League's principal seat was in the Swiss city of Geneva. Some of the foreigners at Addis Ababa, having given us information by way of friendship, had spoken to us about the League, and we had studied a great deal of the literature about it. Consequently, we convened the great nobles and all our ministers and delivered to them the following speech. It would be of great benefit if Ethiopia were to enter the League of Nations. It is necessary, however, in future to improve gradually our entire machinery of government, and therefore we ask them to let us know their present thoughts, lest we should experience difficulties in the League if we fail to improve our governmental procedures once we had entered the League. The nobles and ministers declared unanimously that it was impossible to effect major improvements within 1 year, but that it was their wish to improve the entire work of government year by year in slow stages, and therefore it was right for us to enter the League. Hence the question of our entry was decided. After this, we sent to Geneva a delegation with our letter on 1st Nahase 1914, which is to say 7th August 1922, consisting of Dejismach Nedau as leader, Ato Heroi Welde Selassie and Ato Fasica as aides. with instructions that they should sign in our name as soon as our entry into the League had been granted. As our envoys informed us, there was for a time a little difficulty with regard to the application which the Ethiopian government had presented in order to enter the League of Nations, but later on the French delegate M. de Juvenel and the former French minister plenipotentiary in Ethiopia, M. Legarde, helped a great deal, and consequently the British and Italian delegates declared their goodwill towards Ethiopia's entry into the League. The assembly therefore gave full approval, and our envoys signed the accord and returned. There was great joy at Addis Ababa. The rejoicing was for no reason other than we thought that the covenant of the League would protect us from the sort of attack which Italy has now launched against us. Chapter 14, about our efforts to free the slaves and the progressive improvement year by year in the struggle for their liberation. It had been customary in the past in Ethiopia, a part of Africa, just as it had been in Asia, Europe, and America, to sell and to buy slaves. Nevertheless, the number of those who arrived by way of sale and purchase was small, for the majority of slaves came through capture in war. The reason is that in Ethiopia, from the 15th to the 18th century, the power of Muslims and pagans had prevailed against her, gradually and little by little. While many of her provinces rebelled against the reign of the emperor, establishing their own nobility and looting the country. But later on, the kings before us, and in particular Emperor Menelik, conquered these provinces in battle to restore them as of old to the unity of Ethiopia. And as for all those who had come by way of capture in war, it had been the custom that they should live in slavery to their captor, in accordance with ancient usage. Nevertheless, those who had come as prisoners of war were scarcely distinguishable in appearance, except for a few, from other Ethiopians, and therefore it is very difficult to identify them as slaves. Thus the slavery of some was in name only, but in their mode of living they were not much different from their captors. They were able to purchase and to sell, rest hereditary land ownership, or, like other people, to have rest rights established by the government, to attain officers or ministerial rank in government service or in the service of the church, the rank of deacon, priest, monk, or priorship of a monastic order, or the deanship of a cathedral. As they were indistinguishable in appearance and mode of life, they could even be married to their captor or his son or his relations. When their captor died, he might leave them rest and money in his will, having treated them like his children. Again, as is the practice all over the world, there are many people in each province who are doing a day's work being taken in service for a wage. Yet, while the Italians knew all this, they spread it about that there were slaves rather than workers employed for a wage in some rich man's house. They spread these rumors, exaggerating to the point of perjury. The story which proves that this is that of a rich man who was descended from a Gala family and who lived in the Harar region. This man, by the abundance of his goodness and his conscience, said that it was more useful to give one's money to one's relatives than to give it to alien workers, and thus collected the children of his brothers and sisters and relatives and employed them for wages. But the Italian council at Harar, without knowing or examining all this, wrote a report to his government claiming that such and such possessed so many slaves. As this appeared to his government to be true, it preferred an indictment against us and presented it to the League of Nations. Apart from the slaves who were set free by the proclamation and ordinance which we promulgated as regards the liberation of slaves, we were doing everything possible to set free the slaves by seeking several other opportunities. Thus, the governor of Beni Shangul, Sheikh Hohele, told us that in his country, many slaves had gone free by virtue of the proclamation and ordinance, whereupon we said to him, "You cannot expect to be praised for those who are set free on the basis of the proclamation and ordinance, but if you release them of your own free will, that will bring you credit." As he told us, "It is with my permission that so many slaves go free." He sent them subsequently to Addis Ababa, and we informed him that we were arranging for them to receive instruction. When those slaves were sent to Addis Ababa, we gave orders that they should receive a certificate of their liberation. They immediately entered a military school and began to study. Many of them were selected for musical education, and M. André Nicot, whom we had recruited from Switzerland, taught them music. When they had completed their training, we provided them with a uniform, and they lived in clean dwellings which we had constructed for them. All the foreign envoys and consuls at Addis Ababa knew about our awarding to one of them, who had excelled in knowledge, the rank and uniform of a lieutenant, command of 100, and about our decorating him with an order. They also knew that others with him had carried out properly the work of musicianship. Everyone who saw and knew this Shankela, who had received the rank of lieutenant, used to admire him, for his height was 2.10 meters. And now we hear that in Gembot 1928, which is to say May 1936, when the Italians entered Addis Ababa, they captured him and killed him. But in view of what we have done for the emancipation of the slaves and for civilizing them through education, it is amazing that the Italians should make representations to the League of Nations to the effect that Sheikh Ogele had sent to the emperor a special tribute of slaves. As we have shown above, this slavery problem is recognized in the hearts of men as something that is not preordained by nature in terms of master and slave, but had yet remained firmly established by custom. Consequently, emperors Theodotros, Theodore, Johannes, and Menelik, who reigned in Ethiopia from 1845 to 1906, which is to say 1852-53 to 1913, had promulgated decrees against the sale and purchase of slaves in Ethiopia. But because at that time it was not customary to set up special offices for the work of this kind, their intention remained unaccomplished, as it was impossible to observe and enforce the decree on account of the vastness of the country. But now, since we accept the responsibility for the affairs of government as region plenipotentiary of the Ethiopian realm, we followed on the foundations laid, as regards the liberation of slaves, by the three kings whose names have been mentioned above, and let it be known by proclamation on 22nd Megabit 1916, which is to say 31st March 1924, that in Ethiopia slaves were no longer to be sold or purchased. We promoted an ordinance by which people were to be punished who in future were found to be selling or purchasing slaves, and by which slaves were to go free who had come by way of purchase or capture prior to the proclamation. At Addis Ababa and in other regions, offices and courts were set up by which the proclamation and ordinance were to be enforced, and for this work we recruited an advisor from England, Mr. de Halpert, as judges and secretaries were appointed, and the entire work of administration progressively improved very greatly. Many slaves were set free. Their number was above the 100,000. The number of those set free each year is to be found in the register of the League of Nations at Geneva. Again, when in 1923, which is to say 1931, a delegation sent by the British Anti-Slavery Society came to Addis Ababa, we informed them orally and in writing, after a great deal of discussion, that we shall see to it within 15 or at the most 20 years from now, all slaves would go free, and that slavery would be totally eliminated from Ethiopia. But in any country, a few offenders must always be expected. And if some men are found transgressing the proclamation that has been promulgated, all the foreign envoys know that we have punished them even with a penalty of death. Therefore, our conscience does not rebuke us, for we have done unceasingly everything possible as regards the liberation of the slaves. Chapter 15. About the honor of invitations extended to us to visit Europe. Ethiopia is a realm which has lived steadfast in her independence for more than three millennia. But in the early 16th century, Ahmad Gran emerged from the east of Ethiopia, from Zeila, penetrated into central Ethiopia and fought with Emperor Lebna Dengel. The latter struggled, retreating towards northern Ethiopia, while Gran set fire to all the palaces and churches. Apart from a few books which had remained hidden in caves and islands, he burnt the majority of works of history and culture. Nevertheless, if anyone seeks to know Ethiopia's antiquity, there exist many books which discuss Ethiopian history, written in Greek, Latin, Portuguese, and Arabic, and by reading these, he will be able to inform himself of her great age. It is in fact that many people had come to Ethiopia before the birth of our Lord from Jerusalem, Greece, Arabia, and Egypt. After the birth of our Lord, from the 15th century to the 18th, visits by some foreigners to Ethiopia were fairly continuous. The reference is again, no doubt, to the 16th to 19th century. It is only in this 19th century that the Italians have begun to cast their eyes upon Ethiopia. There are many who went abroad on the part of the Ethiopian clergy. On the part of the government, however, my father, His Highness Ras Makonnen, had gone to Italy in 1881, that's to say 1888-89, and to England during the reign of His Majesty King Edward VII in 1894, that's to say 1902. In the same year, he had visited France en route. Other leaders had gone on missions to Germany, Russia, France, and Turkey. Since for this reason Ethiopia had become known throughout Europe, and since Emperor Menelik had concluded treaties of friendship and commerce with various governments, the countries mentioned above had begun to establish consulates and legations at Addis Ababa on account of the many foreign traders and travelers arriving in Ethiopia. Later in 1909, that's to say 1916, when Queen Zaudetu sat on the throne, she being without son and heir, I was chosen by the will of God and by the wish of the people as Crown Prince and Regent Plenipotentiary of the Ethiopian realm, and consequently I gave full expression to the desire that the friendship with European governments begun in Emperor Menelik's time be progressively widened and strengthened to the utmost. Because the European governments had heard from their envoys at Addis Ababa and had become convinced of the fact that this, my desire, was real and true, they extended to us the honor of an invitation to come to their respective countries to see the prosperity of their country, the good fortune and riches of their people, the beauty of their cities, and the wisdom and knowledge of their scholars. The first invitation was from the President of the French Council of Ministers, M. Poincaré. This was followed by invitations from the King of Belgians, His Majesty Albert, from the Italian King, His Majesty Victor Emmanuel, from the King of England and Emperor of India, His Majesty George V, from the King of Egypt, His Majesty Fouad I, from the President of the Greek Republic, Admiral Kondratiotis, and from the Duchess Charlotte of Luxembourg. As we have shown above, some nobles had gone to Europe on various missions. Yet it was not customary for the Crown Prince and Regent Plenipotentiary of the realm to go abroad, and therefore the distinguished invitations which the European governments had extended to us was a strange thing for all the princes and nobles and the army. They had thus great difficulty over this matter. When we heard this, we gave instructions to have the princes and nobles convened in a great assembly. In the end, they all accepted the matter with pleasure, because we had convinced them that by our planning to go on extending our friendship with the governments of Europe, we were causing people to meet in trade and in work and getting to know each other as a sign of friendship. That for this main purpose, kings and princes were being brought closer together in mutual direct discussions, and that this would induce them to come and visit our country. After the question of our journey had come before the assembly and had been decided, we gave orders that everything necessary for our travel be prepared. We gave instructions that, while our war minister Fitzarari Ebt Agiorgis carried the principal responsibility for the affairs of the government, each minister was to be responsible for the work of his department, and that all them should report to Her Majesty Queen Zaudetu on everything they had done. I had the hope and conviction that my journey to Europe would give me three benefits. One, to see with my own eyes European civilization and the beauty of the cities of Paris, London, Rome, Brussels, Athens, and Cairo, about which I have read in books, first at school and later on in office. 2. When returning to my country after my visit to Europe, I thought it would be possible to initiate some aspects of civilization I had observed with my own eyes, although it would be impossible to carry this out all at once and in full. 3. To find a seaport prior to our journey, we had received some encouragement from France and Italy as regards access to the sea. Afterwards, on Thursday, 8th Miyazia, 1916, which is to say 16th April 1924, we set out from Addis Ababa and went down to Djibouti. Here are the names of the princes and nobles to whom it had been granted to accompany us. Ras Hailu Tekle Haimanot, Raseyu Mengesha, Tejesmach Nidau Abawalo, Tejesmach Gaza Weltehana, Tejesmach Gebre Selassie, Barya Gaber, Tejesmach Mulegeta Yegazu, Tejesmach Haile Selassie Abaina, Legaba Wadejewebe, Blata Herui Wolde Selassie, Lich Makonen, Indalg Kacheu, Tejesmach Wand Bewesan Kasa, Atosahle Tsadalu. When we reached Djibouti, the governor, M. Julian, received us with honor, and after that, on 12th Miyazia, 20th April, we embarked on the Messageries Maritimes Company's boat Portos and traveled to the Suez Canal. As we reached the Suez Canal, an envoy of His Majesty King Fahd arrived and transmitted to us the king's greetings. The patriarch Abuna Kerilos sent Abuna Johannes, who became patriarch later on, and gave us his blessing. When we reached Kantara, we traveled to Jerusalem on the special train which His Majesty King Fahd had arranged for us. At Jerusalem, the British High Commissioner, Sir Herbert Samuel, and the bishop of the various churches came to the railway station and did us the honor of welcoming us. As by the chance of good fortune, the festival of the Resurrection, Easter, was approaching. We thanked God for granting us to see the light of the Easter festival. Afterwards, as we toured Jerusalem and its districts, we visited and kissed all the holy places, including Bethlehem, where our Lord was born, Nazareth, where He grew up, the Jordan, in which He was baptized, Cana of Galilee, where He did miracles, the Sea of Tiberias, where He taught, and the neighboring Capernaum, Bethsaida, Magdala, as well as Hebron, where Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are buried. Although a beginning had been made in discussing the affairs of our sanctuary at Jerusalem with our Coptic fathers in faith, the matter had remained unresolved, and therefore we informed the Coptic Archbishop at Jerusalem, Abuna Timotheos, in writing that he should persist pondering on our proposals, for we had suggested that we should conclude the matter after friendly discussion upon our return from Europe. He wrote to us the following reply: I have already made known your intentions to the Coptic community. Afterwards, as we had heard that the Greeks possessed an area of many chambers in Golgotha, we requested the Greek Orthodox Patriarch in Jerusalem, Abuna Demianos, through the intermediacy of Dr. Zervos, the Greek consul general at Addis Ababa, that he should give one room to the Ethiopian monks as a patrimony for the celebration of Holy Mass. When he replied that they would give one room as patrimony in the monastery of Abraham, we said that we, on our part, would assign a benefice to the Greek monastery in Ethiopia. After reaching agreement and accord on the proposal, we signed the following written convention: The Ethiopian Crown Prince and Regent Plenipotentiary, Teferi Makonnen. 1. One hand. In the name of the Ethiopian people and Patriarch Demianos of Jerusalem, on the order, in the name of the Greek Orthodox community, have agreed and contracted as follows. First, His Beatitudes Demianos, in his capacity as Greek Orthodox Patriarch of Jerusalem and all Palestine, on the occasion of the visit of pilgrimage to Jerusalem of the Ethiopian Crown Prince and Regent Plenipotentiary, while desirous to manifest his great good intentions for the Ethiopian people and the staunch friendship which has existed for a long time between the Ethiopian people and the Holy Church in Jerusalem, has assigned to the Ethiopian people as outright patrimony a room in the Holy Monastery of Abraham near the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. The length of the room is 18 by 70 meters. Its width is 8 by 95 meters, and its height 4 by 95 meters. The room being the basement underneath the dining hall of the fathers has a strong vaulted ceiling. Its ancient door leads to the place where the Holy Cross was found. This room has been given for the requirements of the service of the Ethiopian clergy. Second, this room is to be connected by a door to Deir el Sultan. It shall be the duty of the Ethiopians to have the opening made. The patriarch will extend his help so that this door be opened. Third, the two front doors leading to Abraham's monastery shall be closed, but the windows are not to be blocked. Fourth, it is not permitted to sell, to exchange, or to mortgage this room, or to assign it to any other purposes except to the service of the clergy mentioned above. Fifth, before this room is redecorated, it is necessary to inform the patriarch. He will send a person expert in this kind of work. Sixth, if someone else comes along laying claim to the room given to the Ethiopian community, HB, the patriarch, accepts responsibility to argue the case. As the Crown Prince of Ethiopia and Regent Plenipotentiary, His Highness Tefara Mekonnen desires that the friendship which exists between the Ethiopian people and the patriarch be strengthened. He has granted permission that a representative of the patriarch should permanently reside in Ethiopia, that the following gift be handed over, and that the deed be inscribed in the land register in the name of the patriarch, in accordance with the custom of the country. The gift is as follows. 1. 5 gashas of arable land for the church and residence of the clergy, located no further from Addis Ababa than a day's journey. 2. He will provide 1 gasha of land for the building of the covenant and the church in the neighborhood of Addis Ababa, in the Gulale or Shola regions. These 6 gashas of land, it has been agreed, are not to be transformed for whatever reason to a non-Orthodox community or a non-Orthodox church. 7th, the two parties who have made these mutual gifts have caused this convention to be made out in 2 equal copies and have set their seals and signatures to it, written in the holy city of Jerusalem on 16th Miyazia 1916, which is to say 24th April 1924. But as it was not God's will, this treaty never came into force. After we had concluded our business at Jerusalem, we went to Cairo by train on Miyazia 23rd, which is to say 1st May 1924. At Cairo, His Majesty King Fahd received us with honor at his palace. Our pleasure was exceedingly great when both of us expressed the wish in our discussions to go on in future developing and friendship which had remained firm between our two governments since ancient times. On the next day, the patriarch Abuna Kerrios informed us of his intention to hold mass and prayers in our honor in the church of Saint Mark, and we went to the church. The patriarch, suffering from the weariness of old age, was seated on his throne by the altar and gave us his blessing. As the churches of Egypt and Ethiopia were in a relationship of mother and child, and because the patriarch had for long had the desire and intention of coming to Ethiopia to see his children in faith, he spoke at length of his sadness at his continued inability to come on account of the distance, while at the same time revealing the fulfillment of his desire and thought at seeing with his own eyes our arrival at Cairo today. Afterwards, while we were in the church, the patriarch entered the reception hall for guests at one side. We having brought him, in order to honor our father in faith, a golden crown and golden cross, a golden staff, a silk tunic embroidered with gold, and a cape. He was, therefore, waiting for us wearing the crown and cape, holding the golden cross in his right hand and the golden staff in his left. He was thinking to please us, although because of his great age and weariness, he was not really capable. As we entered the hall from the church, he attempted to receive us standing, but he was not able to do so. Although we were pleased in our heart at seeing His Holiness in this dignity, we felt much grief at thinking of his old age and weariness. The following are the sites which we visited during our stay at Cairo and which have remained memorable to us: the pyramids and the Sphinx, the Great Museum of Antiquities, the great schools and hospitals of the government and of the Copts, the old churches of early times, the antiquities of Luxor, and the tomb of Tutankhamun, which had been discovered at the excavations nearby, as well as great mosques and the famous Islamic college called Al-Azhar. Subsequently, when we saw 4 students from Ethiopia, we were pleased as their teachers said that they would return to Ethiopia within 2 years upon conclusion of their studies. From Cairo, we went to Alexandria and paid homage at the tomb of St. Mark. We then saw the school at which they are teaching more than 4,000 boys and which had been instituted near the church by Abuna Yohannes, the deputy archbishop of the See of St. Mark. After this, we visited Victoria College, which had been built at a place called Ramle near Alexandria and where some boys from Ethiopia were studying. The headmaster of the school, Mr. Reed, was like a father, particularly to the boys from Ethiopia, and we had heard of his gentle treatment and of his teaching, and among the boys there we met Sirak Herui. Our heart was touched with joy when we saw them face to face, the son of Ras Mulugeta Asreta and a boy called Gebre Madhen Aweka had come with us in order to study at this school, and we handed them over into the headmaster's care and trust. Chapter 16, about our journey from Alexandria to Paris. On the first gunboat, 9th May 1924, we embarked on a boat called Cordelere, and when the ship began its journey, a farewell salute was fired by cannon. On the 6th of gunboat, 14th May, when we had passed Corsica and came within view of the great fortifications at Toulon, a warship came to receive us. From there until we approached Marcellis, many airplanes were hovering in the air. As 5 warships passed on the right and left of our ship, they fired their guns. As we disembarked from the ship, the prefect of the district of Marcellis and the mayor of the city, together with many officials, received us. Among these, we were very pleased to see and to meet M. Lagarde, who, since the days of my father, His Highness Rasmakonnen, had been the friend of Ethiopia and ourselves, and had formerly been France's envoy extraordinary and minister plenipotentiary in Ethiopia. After we had rested a little in the Marcellis government buildings, the officers of the warships came and took us to the sea once more in order to show us the warships. Thus we saw the strength of the construction and the size of the guns, and then returned greatly impressed. On the morrow, 8th Gembot, 16th May, in the evening, we departed by train for Paris, and when we reached Paris at 4:30 in the morning, that's to say 10:30 a.m., the new President of the Republic, H.E.M. Millerand, and the Prime Minister, M. Poincaré, all the ministers in full, Marshal Foch, and many other generals received us with great honor. It was in the Quai d'Orsay, in the palace of the foreign ministry, that quarters had been prepared for us, and seated with the president in an automobile, we proceeded along the parade. After we had rested a little in the palace, we went on a return visit to the president of the republic at the Elysee Palace, and subsequently returned. The program had laid down that afterwards we should visit the Paris Municipality, Hotel de Ville, and at the appointed hour, we proceeded there. When we arrived, we found assembled there the President of the Republic and all the ministers, army officers, and the city's notables. When we entered the Great Hall, the Mayor, President du Conseil Municipal, M. Juillard, and the President of the Municipal Councillors, made a speech of friendship which greatly touched our heart, and they expressed to us their pleasure. All the amazing things which we saw in Paris and its surroundings were very numerous. Of the many sights we saw during our stay at Paris, the following are the principal ones: the tomb of Napoleon, Invalides, the airport, and an airplane display, a tank parade and movement exercise, the opera, Notre Dame de Paris, the Palace of Justice, the Mint. This is the place where the coins were struck on which the effigy of Menelik II appears. The offices of the Legion d'Honneur, the Eiffel Tower, the Palace of Versailles, the Palace of Fontainebleau, the Radio Assembly Hall in Saint Elysée, perhaps Saint Assisi, the Artillery College and Artillery Range. It was quite impossible to express in words, on account of the abundance of joy in our heart, the pleasure we felt until the official visit ended, when we were hearing speeches of friendship which were delivered at receptions and banquets, beginning with the President of the Republic, H.E. M. Millerand, and including the Prime Minister, M. Poincaré, and other French authorities, and also when we inspect the various palaces which we have enumerated above. When our official visit was over, we thought of staying on here in Paris in order to have friendly discussions about some matters with the French government and with the Franco-Ethiopian Railway Company. And secondly, as we were desirous to rest here in Paris on our return at the conclusion of each of the official visits to the other governments who had done us the honor of an invitation, we told our friend M. Lagarde that he should seek and arrange for us a rented rest house when he let us know of the readiness of a house on the outskirts of Paris called Villa Camastrand. We went there now at the conclusion of the official visit and took up residence. As soon as it was known that the official days were over, the Ethiopian boys whom we had sent to France for their studies assembled and came to meet us. Andarge Masai, who was among them, made the following speech of thanks in the name of all of them. Your Highness, we feel pride in our heart when we read, and when we find it written by foreign historians, that our Ethiopian forefathers in ancient times excelled the whole world in wisdom and in strength, and that they were honored and feared as they made their power known as far as the land of Egypt by establishing their cities in Meroe and Napata. But as it is the Gittes language that all our books in our country were written, and as the skill of printing did not exist, it makes us very sad that, apart from a few scholars, the people as a whole do not know the history of the country. But now, through your goodness and your endeavor, the whole world had been impressed by your sending us abroad for study, thinking that Ethiopia will be civilized in wisdom and in knowledge as of old, and that she will open her eyes. The whole world has been impressed by your founding of schools at Addis Ababa and in other provinces, by your establishing a printing press and causing ancient books which had been written in Gittes to be translated into Amharic and to be printed, as well as bringing good fortune to the people. We, Ethiopia's sons, remain unceasingly grateful to you because you have made us study, helping all those of us in difficulty, so that we should follow European civilization and should know Ethiopian history. But now, the distinguished invitation which the European governments have extended to you, and not to any of the kings of Ethiopia in the past, has come because they know that under your excellent guidance, you will cause Ethiopia to be civilized, and your arrival has made the name of Ethiopia heard all over the world. Ethiopia has a duty to thank you, for her joy is not only for the present moment, but will be lastingly transmitted from generation to generation. And we in Paris are convinced of our good fortune in seeing our three-colored flag fluttering suspended on the masts. Therefore, the whole Ethiopian people, the dead ones in heaven, the living on earth, are in duty bound to give praise. He concluded, speaking at length. In support and encouragement of the speech which had been delivered, we reassured them in the following peroration. Our thought, as we are helping everybody to the best of our ability, is not only for the few of you here, but for all the sons of Ethiopia who should have the opportunity of acquiring education and knowledge. We pray to God that He may grant you to serve your country Ethiopia by persevering in education and by acquiring wide knowledge. For the future, have courage, for we shall help you to the best of our ability, so that you should not have any sort of financial difficulty until you finish your studies. They expressed to us their heartfelt joy at what we had said to them. As the official visit ended and we were staying in the specially arranged accommodation, important Frenchmen who had been friends of the Ethiopian government, and in particular of His Highness my father, as well as of myself, began to arrive and to pay us visits. After this, we requested an appointment with the Prime Minister, M. Poincaré, in order to discuss amicably several matters, and on the appointed day, we went to the Foreign Ministry. What we had intended to discuss was that the French should give us a free gateway to the sea at Djibouti, and prior to our departure from Addis Ababa, as we informed the French Minister, that this was a matter we particularly wished to discuss. Some hope had been given to us. Consequently, if they agreed to do this, they should let us know what it is that the French government wished to have in exchange for this from us. Secondly, the Treaty of Friendship between the Ethiopian and French governments, referred to as the Klobukowski Treaty, and in particular the judicial matters laid down in paragraph 7, were extremely irksome to us, and without abrogating the treaty, the two governments, while maintaining its usefulness, might cause a few improvements to be effected. When we informed M. Poincaré of these our intentions, he gave us his word that he would present our plan to Parliament and that they would think about it in the most friendly possible manner. Chapter 17, about our journey from Paris to Brussels. The Belgian ambassador in Paris had informed us that on 14th Gembot, 22nd May, the King of the Belgians, H.M. Albert, would officially receive us, and therefore we departed from Paris towards evening and went to Brussels. At the railway station, His Majesty King Albert, together with his ministers and his army officers, did us the honor of an unforgettable welcome. It was in a wing of the main palace building in which His Majesty lived that quarters had been prepared for us. We went there and rested a little. Afterwards, he introduced to us Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth and Prince Leopold, his crown prince, who later on became king, and his daughter, Prince Marie Jose. At the banquet, His Majesty assured us of his complete desire that the firm friendship between the Belgian and Ethiopian governments should in future continue to grow. Of the things we saw at Brussels and in other Belgian provinces during our stay in the country, the following remain vividly in our memory: the Brussels municipality, horse racing, the Bank of Brussels, the Congo Museum, crop improvement and cattle breeding stations, Waterloo, where Napoleon was defeated, the city of Ghent and its match factory, the city of Liege and its munitions factory, the city of Antwerp, the city of Maraj. We also saw coal mines and other similar industrial establishments. From Brussels to Luxembourg. The Grand Duchess Charlotte of Luxembourg, when she heard of King Albert's invitation to us to visit Brussels, still before our departure from Addis Ababa, informed us through the Belgian minister at Addis Ababa, M. Gerard, that we should visit her country during our journey, as Luxembourg was very near to Belgium. We had, therefore, accepted her invitation and now proceeded from Brussels to Luxembourg. At the railway station, the Grand Duchess' husband, Duke Felix, received us with a large guard of honor and after that took us to the palace. But it so happened that on the day we reached Luxembourg, the Grand Duchess gave birth to a son. She therefore informed us by letter of her regret at being unable to sit next to us at the luncheon party. We told Prince Felix that it would remain in our heart as a remembrance of joy that on the day of our arrival in Luxembourg, the Grand Duchess should give birth to a male child. The Prince assured us repeatedly of his pleasure at our visit to Luxembourg, and after taking our leave of the Grand Duchess by message, we returned to Brussels. As our official visit to Brussels was completed, we took our leave of the King and Queen on 23rd Gambot, 31st May, and returned to Paris. Our journey to Stockholm, the capital of Sweden. Having come to Europe, we had the intention of visiting the countries of Europe as a whole, even though not officially, but because the time was approaching for us to return to our country, and although it was impossible to visit all the European countries, we made a firm resolve to visit at the same time the countries in Northern Europe which it was convenient for us to inspect, i.e. Holland, Germany, and Sweden. But as we were planning to stay at Stockholm, the Swedish capital, for about 3 days, we informed the Swedish minister in Paris, and after he had notified his government and obtained permission, he arranged for everything on our journey to go smoothly. Subsequently, on 29th Gambot, 6th June, we departed from Paris and reached Amsterdam by way of Brussels, and after seeing the Dutch cities of Rotterdam and The Hague, as our train stopped for about 3 hours at Amsterdam, we made a tour of inspection of the city by car. From there, we traveled through the whole night, and at dawn, we reached the German harbor city of Hamburg. After touring the town for about an hour, we set out for Sweden. After crossing the water called the North Sea, which lies between Germany and Sweden, we arrived at Stockholm on 1st Sinai, 8th June, at 3 o'clock in the morning, that's to say 9 a.m. When we reached Stockholm, His Majesty King Gustav Adolf had not yet returned from his country home where he had gone for vacation. We therefore put up at the Grand Hotel Royal. On this day was Pentecost, and therefore the Archbishop of Uppsala, Nathan Söderblom, sent an envoy and told us, because of the Feast of Paraclete, Pentecost, we shall be holding prayers and a sermon towards evening, and we beg that it may be your wish to attend. We departed from Stockholm at 9 o'clock, that's to say 3 p.m., and reached Uppsala at 10 o'clock, that's to say 4 p.m. The provincial governor and the archbishop received us at the station. Up to the time when the prayers and sermon began, we inspected the University of Uppsala and the library. In the library, we were very pleased to see some Ge'ez and Amharic books. When the hour of the prayers and the sermon came, we went to the church. The archbishop, being at an elevated place, read the appropriate extracts from Pentecost from the Bible and gave a long sermon. After this, he spoke about Ethiopia as follows. It is a fact that Ethiopia accepted Christianity a long time prior to us. It is only after the steadfast Christians who live upon those heights of Africa that we Swedes, having accepted Christianity, became families and communities of Christ. And now it is an unforgettable experience for us to be host with friendly greetings to the Crown Prince of Ethiopia, the Regent Plenipotentiary, who has come from those elevated parts of Africa. When he had finished speaking at length, my heart was touched with joy at his truly inspiring address, and I therefore replied as follows. Your Beatitude, all the Christians in the world, although they may be divided in some minor matters, yet in essence, there is no one who does not know that there is one Christ only. In former times, on account of the geographical distance, Sweden and Ethiopia did not know each other, even by reputation. But now, ever since some Swedes have begun to come to Ethiopia and had recounted in words the beauty of their country and demonstrated by the work the goodness of the people, many Ethiopians wish to see Sweden and to meet the people. There are many who do not know Ethiopia's history and her acceptance of Christianity 1600 years ago, but you, knowing her Ethiopia's acceptance of Christianity even before Sweden did so, have spoken with conviction, and therefore I wish to thank you in my own name and in that of the whole people of Ethiopia. Today, on this great day of Pentecost, having made the acquaintance of the Swedish people, I express the hope that this may be an omen of the progressive strengthening and widening of the friendship of the two realms. When I had finished speaking, all the people assembled there, beginning with the archbishop, expressed to us their heartfelt pleasure. We subsequently returned to Stockholm. Since our visit to Stockholm was private and not official, we had not had any thought of meeting the king. But as soon as the king heard of our arrival at Stockholm, he sent a message that it would give him pleasure if we could meet now that we had come to Stockholm. We accepted his unofficial invitation and went to the seaside palace called Tulgarm. The king, together with his courtiers, was awaiting us standing by the gate of the palace, and we met with warm affection and friendship. When we had rested a little in the great hall, a festive luncheon was served. After lunch, we remained talking about the means by which the friendship between the two governments might progressively develop and by which the peoples of the two realms might get closer to each other. Towards evening, about 5 o'clock, we returned to Stockholm. Of what we saw at Stockholm and surrounding, the following recollections remain in our heart. The new telephone exchange with 80,000 lines, the iron industry, schools, hospitals, and Uppsala University Library. Afterwards, on the 6th of Sane, that is to say 13th June, we set out from Stockholm, crossed the North Sea, and when we reached the German city of Hamburg, we disembarked from the train and toured the city by car for about 3 hours. And on the following day, 7th Sinai, 14th June, we re-entered Paris. Chapter 18, about our journey from Paris to Rome. We left Paris on 9th Sinai, 16th June, and reached Rome on the 11th, 18th June. The King of Italy, His Majesty Victor Emmanuel, and the leader of the government, Signor Mussolini, with a guard of army officers, received us with honor at the railway station, thus causing much pleasure. It was in the Quirinale, previously the Pope's palace, in which His Majesty lived, that accommodation had been prepared for us, and we proceeded there. When we appeared together with the king standing on the upper balcony to salute the people, all the crowd assembled in the square began shouting with one voice joyfully, "Long live Italy! Long live Ethiopia! Long live His Highness Crown Prince Tafari!" When they think of this today, how extraordinary must this appear to them. At the banquet, His Majesty the King of Italy delivered the following speech. "Your Highness, it has given me great pleasure to welcome Your Highness to the city of Rome with sentiments of amity. Your arrival today recalls to me the visit a long time ago of your father, His Highness Rasmakonnen. It is my sincere wish that the government, which God by His desire has given in your hands, may continue to prosper. Your Highness, prudence has already done a great deal for the country's prosperity and expansion. Your visit to Italy now will, I believe, progressively strengthen the friendship and mutual benefit between the two governments. The deeds of kindness which you did for Italy during the Great War will never be forgotten. We, on our part, have greatly assisted Ethiopia to enter the League of Nations. Therefore, the friendship which exists between the two governments will be of mutual benefit." He then concluded by saying, "I pray that God's blessing may descend upon Ethiopia." I then delivered the following speech. "Your Majesty, having come all the way from Ethiopia, my joy is abundant in seeing Your Majesty, your beautiful country, and your beloved people. I am indeed fortunate in coming to Rome to bind together the ties of friendship between the two governments which were established a long time ago. I am very pleased about your recalling the name of my father, His Highness Rasmakonnen. All the people who heard my father tell of the glorious welcome given to him when he came to Italy during the reign of King Umberto, your father, were greatly impressed. And now that I have arrived here, I am very pleased about the marvelous reception which Your Majesty has extended to me. Henceforth, it is my entire intention to have our affection strengthened and our friendship extended, and I believe that Your Majesty's intention is likewise. We Ethiopians consider the speech of the king of a great country to be like a pledge given under oath, and the words spoken by His Majesty the King of Italy, as cited here above, seem to us to argue a stable peace and amity between the two governments, and it did not appear to us a matter of deceit. On 12 Sane, 19th June, we paid a visit to the leader of the government, Signor Mussolini, having requested an appointment to discuss, in a friendly manner, a number of matters. The subject which we planned to discuss was concerned with the amicable granting to Ethiopia of a gateway to the northern parts of the country from the port of Assab, which had originally been under Ethiopian rule and was now an Italian colony. After we had met at the appointed hour, I said to him that it would give us pleasure if he were willing to discuss the amicable cession to us by the Italian government of a part of the port of Assab as a free zone. After Signor Mussolini had listened attentively to this request, he said that he was willing to discuss the matter and that after conversations with the Director of Political Affairs, Contarini, the latter would let me know the answer. Contarini having been summoned immediately, we were introduced to each other. After we had meetings and lengthy discussions with him, Contarini, he told me that he would report to Signor Mussolini everything that we had spoken about and that the reply would reach me tomorrow by the hands of Conte Colli. We then parted. On the morrow, Conte Colli, the Italian envoy extraordinary and minister plenipotentiary in Ethiopia, came and submitted to us a draft treaty, explaining that this was his government's proposal concerning my request as regards the port of Assab. The following is the text of the draft treaty. First, since it is the determined wish of the Italian government to strengthen progressively the ties of friendship which exist between the Italian and Ethiopian governments, and for the financial and political benefit and prosperity of Ethiopia, the Italian government consigns to the Ethiopian government for a period of 99 years an access point to the sea at Assab and a place suitable for a railway from the sea up to the Ethiopian frontier, as well as all the localities and houses which are the property of the Italian government and are situated within the town which hitherto had been in the hands of the Italian government. Until the period of this treaty expires, the Ethiopian government has full sovereignty over the access point to the sea at Assab and over the road to the frontier which it has received from the Italian government. Second, experts whom the Italian and Ethiopian governments will choose are to determine the boundaries in the surroundings of the seaport of Assab, including the houses that have been built, and the ground required for the construction of the railway from the access point at Assab up to the Ethiopian frontier, and they shall determine the boundary in situ, having regard to what is needed for access to the sea and for the trade of Assab. Third, the Ethiopian government, being very desirous to strengthen progressively the ties of friendship which exist between Italy and Ethiopia, will not give economic or political benefit to the citizens of any other government, except to Italian citizens, in the seaport and localities mentioned, as has been agreed in the treaty. All things being equal, precedence shall be accorded to Italian citizens. But the Ethiopian government, if it wishes to employ people in the area, can do what it likes. Fourth, if the Italian government requires a place at which to deposit goods at the gateway to the sea at Assab, the Ethiopian government will let it have a demarcated area. Fifth, when Italian merchants cost merchandise to pass through the Assab free zone, they shall pay customs duty at the same rate at which Ethiopian merchants have to pay. Sixth, the Ethiopian government shall assign the construction of the free maritime zone and of the railway from Assab to the Ethiopian frontier to Ethiopian and Italian companies. When these companies are established, the Ethiopians shall pay two parts of the money and the Italians one part. But if the Ethiopians are unable to raise two-thirds of the money, then the two parties alone, without bringing in any foreigners, may form a company and pay the money half and half. Seventh, if the Ethiopian government in future concludes a maritime access treaty with another government, and if it finds a location or part thereof that is a free zone at whatever other maritime access point, and if it obtains their genuine advantages, then the Italian government agrees by redrawing this maritime access treaty to extend the advantages for Ethiopia. Assuming the Ethiopian government concludes a maritime access treaty with another government, and if that other government obtains advantages by the treaty, then the Italian government may well derive benefit from redrawing this maritime access treaty. 8. With regard to the entire question of frontier treaties previously concluded by the Ethiopian and Italian governments, the two parties agree that border problems be finally settled as soon as experts have been selected from both sides. Furthermore, the Ethiopian government undertakes to assist to the utmost extent possible those Italian companies who had accepted the previous treaty obligations as regards agriculture, commerce, public works, and minerals, lest they should encounter difficulties. 9. As regards the waters of the Juba and Webi Shabelle rivers, the Ethiopian government enters into a contractual agreement not to shut off completely those waters, preventing them from flowing to Italian Somaliland by offering their benefit to foreign interests, notwithstanding any required for Ethiopia's own benefit. 10th, the Italian government enters into treaty obligations not to demand any money from the Ethiopian government for granting it a maritime access point at Asab and adequate ground for the construction of a railway to the Ethiopian frontier, together with all the houses and ground at Asab. After we had studied this draft treaty, we became convinced of the need to inform the council. Upon our return to Addis Ababa, we therefore told Conte Colli to inform Signor Mussolini of this our intention, but for a variety of reasons, the draft treaty never came into force. On 14th Sinai, 21st June, we had been given an appointment to visit the Pope of Rome, Pius VI, and at the appointed hour, we met at the Vatican Palace. The Pope spoke, expressing his pleasure at the fact that Catholic missions were now residing in Ethiopia in peace and security, and that religious freedom was now permitted in Ethiopia, contrary to earlier practice. When we came to take leave of each other, he pronounced a prayer, "May God bless the land of Ethiopia, its kings, and its people." When we emerged from there, we entered the Church of St. Peter and paid homage at the sepulchre. After we had seen the beauty of the church, we went to inspect the nearby monastery of St. Stephen, which had been given to the Ethiopian monks. From the earliest times, Ethiopian monks possessed a strong desire to see and to pay homage at our Lord's sepulchre at Golgotha and the sepulchre of St. Peter and St. Paul at Rome. But when they came to Rome from Ethiopia, they had difficulty in finding lodgings. And it is said that when the Pope, who reigned in 1464, saw their plight, he gave them this monastery, saying, "This monastery of St. Stephen shall be a resting place for Ethiopian monks." As we toured every corner of the church in this monastery, we saw the hewn stones on which the names of the 7 Ethiopian monks had been incised. When we were seated in one of the rooms in the monastery, the 7 Ethiopians who had come here to study approached and expressed their joy to us by referring to the antiquity of Ethiopia and the strength of her kings, and by rendering thanks to us. The following are some of the recollections that have remained in our heart of what we saw at Rome and in the provinces during our stay there. The Arenale Palace, the Mausoleum of the Kings, the motorcycle races, the Rome Municipality, the Vatican and the Church of St. Peter, the Covenant of St. Stephen, the Convent of St. Stephen where Ethiopian boys are studying, the Church of St. Paul and St. John, the Church of Our Lady Mary and of Jesus, the Palace of the Ancient Caesars, the theater in which the Ancient Caesars made Christians fight with wild beasts and slaves fight each other, the Victor Emmanuel II Monument, the military parade at Centocelle, the Rome Museums, the cannon firing at Bracciano, the military hospital called Celio, the ships at Spezia, the city of Turin, the Fiat car factory, and the Royal Mausoleum at Turin. When the days of the official visit were over, we thanked His Majesty King Victor Emmanuel for the friendly reception he had arranged for us, took our leave, and returned to Paris on 25th Sinai, 2nd July. Chapter 19, From Paris to London. On 30th Sinai, 7th July, we set out from Paris and traveled to London. When we reached Calais, we boarded a British ship, as we began the journey, two warships, bedecked with the Ethiopian and British flags, sailed to the right and left of our boat. Having crossed the sea, we reached Dover, and a 21-gun salute was fired. From Dover, we traveled by train, and when we reached the Victoria Railway Station in London, the son of His Majesty King George, now himself king, but at that time styled Duke of York, together with many officers and guards of honor, bade us a distinguished welcome in the name of his father. From there, we went to the residence, which had been prepared for us in a house called Albert Gate near Hyde Park and Knightsbridge. On the morrow, 1st Hamlet, 8th July, so His Highness the Duke of York informed us, was to be the audience granted by His Majesty King George, and at the appointed hour, we went to the meeting. I delivered to His Majesty the following speech. Your Majesty, it has given me great pleasure to see Your Majesty and Her Majesty the Queen in your great capital of London, which was founded a long time ago. Your Majesty is aware that the firm friendship between England and Ethiopia has been established for a long time. For the future, it is the wish of Her Majesty Empress Zaudetu, as well as my own, that the friendship of the two governments should progressively develop and strengthen, and we believe that Your Majesty's intention and wish are likewise. When my august father, His Highness Ras Makonnen, came to London during the reign of your august father, King Edward VII, I was greatly impressed when I heard him tell his officers about all the acts of friendship which had been done to him. And I, his son, having come to London, derived great pleasure from seeing Your Majesty, your honored people, and your beautiful capital, and this joy will remain in my heart as a constant memory. Your Majesty, I would assure Your Majesty of my heartfelt wish that there may be long life in health for Your Majesty, Her Majesty the Queen, and the entire royal house, peace and blessing for your people, prosperity and development for your country. When I had finished speaking, His Majesty replied with the following speech. Your Highness, I thank you from my heart, for I am exceedingly pleased having heard the words of friendship which Your Highness has now spoken. I and the Queen are very pleased at your safe arrival in the capital of the British realm, and at our meeting face to face. I express the hope that the friendship which has existed between the two governments for so long may be Your Highness's arrival be progressively developed and strengthened in future. I recall the visit of His Highness, your father, Ras Makonnen, as a representative of Emperor Menelik at the coronation of my father, His Majesty King Edward. I know full well that Ras Makonnen possessed enduring thoughts of friendship for my country. Likewise, I do not doubt that the same thoughts will forever be with his son. While Your Highness is here, arrangements have been made for you to see, without inconvenience, everything you may require to inspect in my country. Again, while you are with us and enjoying an agreeable and useful time, I hope that when you return to your country, everything you have seen in England will remain a pleasant memory. Now, in thanking Your Highness once again, I would assure you that it is my intention to consolidate our friendship. I would request Your Highness to transmit, upon your return to your country, my cordial and respectful greetings to Her Majesty Queen Zaudetu. I express to you my wholehearted wish that the Ethiopian realm may have happiness and prosperity, blessing and development. He thus concluded his speech. We subsequently returned to Albert Gate, and about 2 hours later, His Majesty came to Albert Gate on a return visit. On the 4th of Hamle, 11th July, an appointment was arranged to discuss some governmental affairs with the Prime Minister, Mr. Ramsay MacDonald, and at the appointed hour, we met at the Foreign Office. After Mr. MacDonald had spoken at length about the disturbances which had occurred at the frontiers between the subjects of the two governments, we replied to him as follows. The border settlement has been made on paper only, and the engineers selected by the governments of both sides, according to the provisions of the treaty, have not delimited the frontiers by a visit on the spot, and no marks have been put in the ground. This is the reason why our subjects and you and yours have come to blows at the borders. It would, therefore, be better if in future we carried out what is required as soon as possible, i.e. determining the frontier and marking it properly. We told him that there could be no doubt that once this had been carried out, the two sides would observe the boundaries. Mr. McDonald agreed with this proposal and said that he would arrange that the matter of the frontier determination be begun at once. When we got back, we saw to it that the work of the border delimitation was carried out. The second matter is concerned with the Lake Tana barrage. Mr. McDonald asked that the Ethiopian government should grant permission to the British government to construct the Lake Tana dam. We replied to him as follows. We ourselves shall cause the Lake Tana barrage to be built. We can, however, talk about the setting up of a company. Once we had completed the construction of the dam, we told him that we would then lease the water to the government of the Anglo-Egyptian Sudan. We concluded by saying that we should transmit details to each other in writing, as we had agreed about the proposal in principle. After this, having asked permission to point out some difficulties on our part, we submitted to him the following request. In the past, Emperor Menelik's reign, a treaty had been concluded that the Ethiopian government, having purchased the arms it considered necessary for itself, should not be impeded conveying those arms to the country. But now, since the Great European War, we were prevented carrying arms which we had purchased, and we asked the Prime Minister to permit us to purchase and conveyance of arms as of old. He replied that the British government were unable to resolve the matter on their own unless they settled this position on the arms embargo in conjunction with the French and Italian governments, and that after consultating among the three governments about this, they would let us know the answer. Secondly, we had experienced great difficulty because the Ethiopian government did not possess a seaport which would bring about contact with foreign countries. It is a fact that skill and wealth are acquired when trade expands as one nation meets and encounters others by sea and by land. The entire object of the Secondly, we had experienced great difficulty because the Ethiopian government did not possess a seaport which would bring about contact with foreign countries. It is a fact that skill and wealth are acquired when trade expands as one nation meets and encounters others by sea and by land. The entire object of the Ethiopian government for the future is to get very close to the foreign countries by undertaking the task of civilization. Indeed, our ascension to the League of Nations last year proves our intention to work for civilization and to develop our country. Therefore, if the British government were to give the Ethiopian government a seaport as patrimony, there would be eternal and unshakable friendship. Hence, I said to the Prime Minister that it would give us pleasure if he would let us have a definite answer before our departure from London. Mr. McDonald replied, I had not heard about this matter until now. I am not able to give you the answer immediately since this has not been debated and determined by Parliament, and I, on my own, am not in a position to decide this. I shall, however, see to it that the matter be submitted to Parliament at the appropriate time, so that its advice can be obtained. On the same day, the Archbishop of Canterbury, the Most Reverend Randall Davison, gave a dinner party for us, and we left Albergate at 7 o'clock to go to Lambeth Palace. After a very pleasant banquet, in our honor, the Archbishop made the following speech. Your Highness, it gives me very great pleasure to welcome Your Highness to the Lambeth Palace, which is the main center of the English Church. From time to time, I receive those who are the important representatives of the branches of the Church of Christ, but there has never before visited Lambeth anyone whose church stands in terms of antiquity in first place among the Christians of the world. Your Highness, your church has an ancient history of about 1600 years. Its beginnings approach the even earlier period of the apostles of our Lord. Your church has a history which is related to the time of Athanasius and his companions, Your Highness is not only holding on to ancient traditions, but it is your glory to develop Christian civilization for the future and to spread the Christian scriptures among your people. From your printing press issue not only ancient and modern religious books, but you yourself are an active participant in the work. The Ethiopian books which Your Highness has caused to be printed have an introduction by you. Everyone who studies the books of Chrysostom and of the monk Mar Yisehak will derive much benefit. It is not to be doubted that the main object of your present journey is to acquaint yourself with the modern Western world, be it in spiritual or in secular terms. Your visit is to all of us a perpetual joy. I feel assured that your country's spiritual and secular well-being is well placed in your hands, and that there is due to you every possible assistance for your beneficent endeavors. He concluded by saying, with cordial friendship and high hopes, we wish that everything for which you have come here may prosper. On the 5th of Hamle, 12th July, as the official visit ended, we went to Buckingham Palace and took leave of His Majesty the King and Her Majesty the Queen. During the farewell visit, His Majesty King George made the following speech. Your Highness has given me great pleasure by your visit to England to develop and strengthen the friendship of our two governments. Hence, so that you may have a constant memorial of your visit to London and of your meeting with us, we are returning to you the crown of Emperor Theodore Tewodros, which the commander of the British army at the time of the Magdala campaign had brought back. Although the capture of Emperor Tewodros, or Theodore's crown, and its removal to England in no way affected Ethiopia's independence, yet to have it said this crown was the crown of an Ethiopian emperor, and to have it appear in a foreign country did not please me. Hence His Majesty King George's gracious permission that this crown of Emperor Tewodros, or Theodore, now be returned to Ethiopia, was, I was convinced, a great mark of friendship, and since I felt very pleased, I expressed to the king my profoundly sincere gratitude. On 11th Hamle, 18th July, we departed from London at 4 o'clock in the morning, that is to say 10 a.m., to visit Cambridge University. Before coming to London, while we were still at Rome, the Vice Chancellor had asked us in writing to be gracious enough to visit the university. After we had reached London, he informed us of his proposal through the Foreign Office, and we therefore went to carry out this engagement. After the professors of the university had given us a respectful welcome, the university's vice chancellor approached and said, Your Highness, as we have heard of your initiative and perseverance in leading your country, Ethiopia, in wisdom and knowledge, we bestow upon you the honorary degree of Doctor of Law. He then gave me the appropriate robes. Immediately afterwards, they arranged for us a great luncheon banquet. At the banquet, the Vice Chancellor, Dr. E.C. Pierce, made the following speech. Your Highness, the poet Homer says the Ethiopians are blameless. Herodotus says the Ethiopians are long-lived because they do not drink wine at all. It is a fact that the Ethiopians refused to pay tribute to Cambyses and to the Persian kings. Subsequently, they turned back victoriously all who came to take their country by force. Who does not know that the Queen of Sheba, having heard of the Solomon's fame, came by camel bearing spices, gold, and gems to try the king with riddles? Who does not know that she returned to her country to be the mother of all the kings? Who does not remember, as the centuries unfolded, their descent from David? Who does not know of their being of the family of the Queen of Candace? All this proves the establishment of their Christianity over the whole of Ethiopia and their possession of an ancient faith over a long history. A man who had studied at Christ College and Cambridge University has, in recent years, revealed to the English people the literature and law books of Ethiopia. Today, there is amongst us Tafara Mekonnen, Ethiopia's crown prince. He follows in the footsteps of his ancestors and possesses knowledge exceeding that of Oriental and Egyptians. He explores ancient and modern knowledge. He has studied all the ancient Christian traditions. He endeavors to acquire modern science. His Highness Tafara Mekonnen is the first Ethiopian crown prince who has gone up in an airplane. He has caused the books of John Chrysostom and of Mar Yisehak to be translated from Kitis into Amharic and had them printed at his own press. These books can be found in the Cambridge University Library. Furthermore, he has built a school for the children of Ethiopia. He ended by saying, "We therefore make known to all of you here, Ethiopia's great crown prince and regent, His Highness Tefara Mekonnen, the hope of Ethiopia, who is descended from ancient kings." We replied with the following speech to that delivered by the university's vice chancellor. "It gives me great pleasure to visit Cambridge University, where the front of learning and wisdom for so many different peoples rises. I thank you for receiving me with manifestations of such great pleasure and cordial friendship. Moreover, my joy is immense when you speak of Ethiopia's history, proving the existence since earliest times of her independence and the people's adherence to Christianity. Perhaps there remain some people who do not know that the Ethiopian realm possesses great antiquity and that it was established a long time ago. But if they study Ethiopian history carefully, they will be able to convince themselves of the firm existence of the Ethiopian realm prior to the Greeks and the Romans. Our country was well known even at the time of David and Solomon. Since Ethiopia entered the League of Nations last year, it is appropriate for her to draw closer to the nations of Europe, as we have sent Ethiopian youth to study in Europe and in other countries, and as they are very diligent in their studies, I hope that in a few years' time, they will come to Cambridge for their university education and then serve their country when they return after graduation." Upon completing my speech, we took our leave and returned to London. Everything I saw in London was truly amazing. The following sights are a perpetual memory engraved in my heart: Buckingham Palace, the Tower of London, St. Thomas's Hospital, the Houses of Parliament, the Zoological Garden, in which many different wild animals can be seen, the High Courts of Justice, St. Paul's Cathedral, the Wembley Exhibition, the Foreign Office, Lambeth Palace, the residence of the Archbishop of Canterbury, the British and Foreign Bible Society, the Bank of England, and Windsor Castle. There remains with me a great admiration for the goodness of the people in terms of innate character and habit rather than political motivation. Afterwards, on 14th Hamley, 21st July, we returned from London to Paris. Subsequently, having come as far as Europe, I felt I could not return to my country without seeing Geneva, where the League of Nations, on which world peace is founded, was established and which we had become members. So on 21st Hamley, 28th July, I went from Paris to Geneva, but as this was the holiday season, the Secretary General was not there, and therefore the secretaries who were there at the time received us with pleasure and showed us all the offices with their various departments. From there, we visited the Swiss capital, Berne, and then returned to Paris. Well, it was my determined wish to visit Berlin, the capital of Germany, privately and quite unofficially. I was sad at my inability to go to Berlin in view of the approach of the time at which I had to return to my country. I therefore arranged that Dejasmach Haile Selassie, Sahlet Sadalu, and Das Fayet Agani, among the officials who were with me, should go to Berlin, taking with them a letter of friendship, and after meeting the President, Marshal Hindenburg, they were to return. In the treaty with the Franco-Ethiopian Railway Company, there were, in some passages, matters which at times gave rise to dispute. We therefore had friendly discussions and agreed without difficulty on 9 paragraphs and had much pleasure in putting our signature to it, together with that of the president of the company, M. Maxim Getten. While we had indicated to M. Poincaré, the foreign minister, during the period when we first came to Paris, the need to find a free access point to the sea at Djibouti, it so happened that there occurred ministerial changes in the presidency and the foreign ministry, yet M. Poincaré had given us hope, explaining that they would let us have the reply at another time, and when we asked that they should give us the answer, as we were now returning to our country, the following letter was written to us by the foreign ministry. 13th Nahase, 1924, Paris. To His Highness Tefara Mekonnen, Crown Prince of Ethiopia and Regent Plenipotentiary. Your Highness, since Your Highness has asked for access to the sea for the purposes of your country's trade, it would have given me pleasure to convey to Your Highness, prior to your departure from here, the terms on which the governments of the two countries might reach agreement and to conclude the investigation of the matter based on the firm desire of the government of the French Republic to grant to the Ethiopian government the access which you have requested, but with the delay of the President of the Council to return speedily from the country to which he has gone, and since the agreement to be concluded is a matter of importance, the whole government of the French Republic must of necessity deliberate on the matter. Therefore, the agreement has not yet been drafted. The matter which you have requested cannot fail to come about, so as to strengthen the friendship of the two governments and likewise the ties of amity, which for long have historically bound the French government to that of Ethiopia. I would respectfully inform you, Your Highness, by declaring that once the matter has again been urgently raised, it will conclude with the firm desire that exists in a written agreement. The time has hitherto remained unpropitious to expedite the entire agreement upon the basis of the benefit which these two friendly and neighboring governments attribute to it. But in the accord which will undoubtedly be concluded in future, Your Highness will find a distinct remembrance based on your visit to France, which justifies the trust you repose in the people's profound friendship. Nothing will be forgotten to bring about what is necessary, so that the recollection of the friendship and mutual benefit of the two countries will continue to flourish. I would request Your Highness to make known on our behalf to the Empress of Ethiopia, Her Majesty Zauditu, the good wishes and goodwill which the government of the French Republic cherishes for her and her people's prosperity. Signed, René Renaud. Although the draft agreement remained unwritten for the time being, yet we were glad when we read this letter, for its wording gave hope that an accord would be concluded within the next future, since we were convinced that the time was approaching when we had to return to our country. We gave orders that the new medal, called the Menelik Second Medal, be struck, and also that of the Menelik Second Statue be constructed and sent to Addis Ababa. That the new stamps with the effigy of the Queen Zauditu and ourselves be printed, and that books required for the ministerial departments be purchased. Chapter 20, From Paris to Athens, the Greek Capital. We had not yet made the acquaintance of the new president of the French Republic, H.E.M. Dumergue, and we therefore met by appointment at the Château de Rambolet. At the same time, we took our leave, and on 7th Nahase, 13th August, we set out from Marseilles on our way to Athens. The French authorities and our old friend M. Lagarde, who escorted us as far as Marseilles, were with us. From Marseilles, we embarked on 9th Nahase, 15th August, on a small ship called Amboise. On the fourth day, when we reached the Greek harbor town of Piraeus, they received us with great honor. Airplanes hovering in the air, and in the sea warships firing their guns. When proceeding from there, we reached the town of Phaleron. The Greek Prime Minister H.E. Monsieur Sophilis, with ministers and army commanders, bade us welcome. From there we traveled by train to Athens. At the railway station, the President of the Republic, H.E. Admiral Kondereotis, together with the country's dignitaries and foreign diplomats, received us. We immediately went to the principal church at Athens, where Archbishop Chrysostomos pronounced a prayer of blessing, and after we proceeded to the palace where lodging had been prepared for us. At the banquet in the evening, the President Admiral Kondoriotis spoke of the friendship which had remained steadfast for a long time between the two countries, as well as the closely knit history of the two peoples. We, on our part, told him that from the time immemorial Athens had been the source of wisdom and knowledge, that we had discovered and read in our history of the goodness of the Greek people, and we declared our intention henceforth to render assistance to all Greeks living in Ethiopia. On the next day, we visited the Acropolis, the ancient sanctuary of gods and idols. When we returned from there, we went to see the Academy of various museums. On the 13th Nahase, 19th August, they showed us various displays of gymnastics at a place called the stadium, as well as several kinds of military parades. Towards evening, we went to see Athens University, and the head of the university, Monsieur Dimitri Papapoulos, standing at an elevated place, made the following speech. Your Highness, it is in the midst of Athens University that the soul of Greece is being revealed. This evening, we are pleased to welcome the representative of a people tied to Greece by inseparable ties and by a friendship that is based on ancient historical traditions. Your Highness's presence amongst us is apt to strengthen and to renew those memories of 1600 years. Two Greeks, the sons of Meropios, the merchant, Frumentius, the Idaceus, were taken prisoner at the Ethiopian seaboard and thus entered the country. They founded the Church of Ethiopia by teaching the country's inhabitants and by becoming apostles of the faith. Your Highness, the affection which binds the two countries together began at that time. In the year 325, Athanasius, the great bishop of Christian Greece, bestowed at Alexandria the name of founder of the Church of Ethiopia upon Frumentius, and did so with great glory, and he also anointed him bishop of the Ethiopian Church. Again, in a different context, Heliodorus of Emesa refers to these historical memories in the Book of Romance, which he wrote. In this book, he presents the Ethiopian king's daughter as beautiful and comely. The Ethiopians were very well known to Homer and to Herodotus, who referred to them in his history, and to Strabo, who speaks about them a great deal in his geography. By virtue of these old traditions, the kings of modern Ethiopia have always cultivated true friendship with Greece. Above all, Emperor Johannes and Emperor Menelik have uttered words of sincere affection for our country in exchanges of letters with the Greek government. Your Highness, our brothers who live in your country are always telling us with feelings of deep gratitude of the welcome and friendship they have encountered among your people. This goes so far that it is virtually granted to them to be like brothers. We are very glad, therefore, to receive together as guests among us the representative of this people. Greek writers who have described the details of their journeys and whose books are read with benefit have emphatically shown the extreme natural beauty of Ethiopia. They have described the different kinds of air currents, trees, and leaves, as well as the beauty of the sun, which, through its light, reveals beauty of the country. Your Highness, for a long time now, the Greeks have considered everything that is good for your country as their own advantage. Each time they find an opportunity, they affirm the thoughts of friendship which they have for the kings of Ethiopia and for the people. This feeling does not only arise from the friendship which you have for us. What we have achieved in our past history and by our character is due to our respect for the supremeness of learning and complete love of freedom to the point of heroism. Therefore, it is not at all a strange thing for us to consolidate our friendship for the Ethiopian people through the study which our history affords us. We are aware that Ethiopia's success in guarding her independence at all times arises from the mountains which have been given to her by nature and which separate her from all the other African countries. It is proper to say that Ethiopia has been the bastion of Christianity for more than a millennia among the savages and pagans in the arid desert. Homer said of the Ethiopians that they excelled above others. Diodorus speaks of their virtue. He admires their fight for their freedom. At the time of Alexander the Great and his heirs, Greek culture had entered Ethiopia and had opened a new road of civilization. It left written monuments, a map which demonstrates its progress. The Ptolemies and the Byzantine kings desired the Ethiopian people to establish a basis and to extend their rule up to the Red Sea. When Byzantium fought with the Persians, it threw into the battle the might of the Ethiopians. Your Highness's country was a crossroads and meeting point of the civilized nations in the Mediterranean and Indian areas. Since the Greeks were at that time held in great honor in Ethiopia, the Ethiopian kings are said to have known the Greek language. According to those who have studied the history of the Ethiopian church, In the 4th century, this church, strong in its faith, was doing everything that was necessary to enable the Christian religion to spread over all the distant lands in Africa. But the rise of Islam and its constant and progressive growth greatly weakened the strength of the Ethiopian people, as Islam defeated, by the force of the sword, the countries in North Africa, but eventually defending themselves with the heroism which derives from their nature, the Ethiopians overcame the might of the Muslims. They built once again the Church of Aksum at the place to which the Muslims had set fire. It may be said that the rebuilding of this church is a great good fortune and luck for Ethiopia. By the intelligence of its kings and rulers since the last century, this country has once again taken the road of renewal. It is this road of renewal that is leading this beloved and courageous people towards national unity and equality. The University of Athens, at this place where the leaders of the Greek people are assembled, greets the courageous ruler of the Ethiopian people, the son of Makonnen. He concluded by saying, "The Greek people request that you will accept their best wishes for the prosperity of the Ethiopian people, as well as their firm resolve for a progressive strengthening of the ties of friendship which exist between the two nations." We were pleased to hear these words of friendship gleaned from ancient history and expressed our profound gratitude. We then returned to the palace. On the morrow, we went to visit, together with Archbishop Chrysostomos and with other scholars very knowledgeable in history, the Areopagos, where St. Paul instructed the Athenians. The place is in the vicinity of the Acropolis. The Archbishop spoke at length about the history of this locality, citing the Acts of the Apostles. We had, of course, frequently read in history books of Athens as the fount of wisdom and learning, and now we were glad to see it with our own eyes. Of all the things we had seen at Athens, the following are the main memories we have retained in our heart. The temples of gods and idols of the Acropolis, the Areopagos, the academy and various museums, the library, the university, the gymnastics displays, and the military parade at the stadium, the theater of Herodotus, Atticus by the ruins of the Acropolis, and the firework projected into the air by the seashore at Phaleron, spread out in the sky in the shape of the Ethiopian flag. Chapter 21, Returning from Athens Home to Ethiopia. Since it had been our long-standing concern that the problem which had arisen between us and our fathers in faith, the Copts, as regards the place of our Jerusalem convent, should be resolved in a friendly manner, we had made written submissions to the Archbishop at the time of our visit to Jerusalem. He had given us the reply that he would reflect upon the matter, and we therefore decided to go from Athens to Cairo in order to ascertain the outcome of the problem, in case he had perhaps been able to consider it already. On the 15th Nahase, 21st August, we set out from Athens and traveled to Alexandria by a ship called Hesperia, for we meant to discuss this problem of our convent at a meeting with the Patriarch Abuna Kerios. From Alexandria, we went to Cairo, and after we had met the Patriarch Abuna Kerios, we were told that the deliberations about the problem of our Jerusalem convent had not yet been concluded by the counselors of the synod, and therefore we felt very distressed. But the time had definitely come for us to return home. Consequently, we left someone behind who would convey to us the news. Once he had heard the outcome of the matter, we then informed the Patriarch of our intention to depart, took our leave, and subsequently traveled to Suez. On Nahase 21st, 27th August, we embarked at Suez on a ship of the Messageries Company called Chile, and reached Djibouti on Nahase 25th, 31st August. Dejesmach now Rasketachu, and Kaxnasmach now Dejesmach Amde, and Bajeron Sehledengle, who had come as emissaries from Her Majesty Queen Zauditu to welcome us at Djibouti, boarded the ship, and after meeting us, handed to us a letter from Her Majesty Queen Zauditu. Its text was as follows: "The Lion of the Tribe of Judah hath prevailed, elect of God, Zauditu, Empress of Ethiopia. May it reach my son, His Highness Tafara Mekonnen, Crown Prince of Ethiopia and Regent Plenipotentiary. How have you been? Thanks be to God, am well. While I was distressed about your toiling in strange and hot countries, when you were thinking only of our country's freedom, respect, and honor, I am now very pleased about your safe return. Thanks are due to God for your return, alive, to Ethiopia, your heritage, after visiting all the countries we had proposed. Moreover, at this, your present journey to Europe was a first-time experience. We had been very anxious, but now, with your safe return, the entire Ethiopian people must be pleased. Having arrived thus in peace, may he grant that we may soon see each other with our own eyes. Deches mach getacho, bajeron sech le tengle, ink as nas mach amde, have come as our emissaries to welcome you. Written at Addis Ababa on 19th Nahase, 1916, 25th August, 1924. We departed from Djibouti on Nahase 26th, 1st September, paused for a day at Diridawa, and entered Addis Ababa on the 29th, 4th September. At the railway station, the foreign diplomatic corps in full, Archbishop Abuna Mateos, together with the hierarchy, ministers and army officers, and the people of the city, pressed for space, were waiting and received us with joy as the gun announcing arrival. As the gun announcing our arrival was fired, when we entered the palace, we presented to Her Majesty Queen Zauditu our affectionate and respectful greetings, and afterwards we delivered the following speech. Your Majesty, when we explore Ethiopian history, the writings of great historians convincingly proved to us that Ethiopia has greater antiquity than most countries, and that she was honored for wisdom and learning. Our Kebrene guest testifies that when the Queen of Sheba went to Jerusalem to hear Solomon's wisdom, she presented to him various gifts she had brought. This proves to us Ethiopia's antiquity and her wisdom. Again, the fact that our fathers, the kings of Ethiopia, have crossed the sea, were governing the Arab country called Yemen, demonstrates that, according to history, Ethiopia was a powerful nation. But because wars with the pagans living all around Ethiopia developed from time to time to Ethiopia's detriment, she failed to find propitious opportunities to get markedly closer to foreign governments. His Majesty, your father, the great Menelik II, together with the mighty ones who supported his throne, conquered once more all the territories that had been lost and made Ethiopia as far-flung as she had been in the past. He did everything possible to bring about a rapprochement with foreign governments. His choice for this task, in the first place, of my father, His Highness Ras Makonnen, who was his brother and servant, shows us that there was great mutual trust between the two. And now, when Your Majesty was meaning to manifest to the whole world Ethiopia's independence, the whole world was impressed by your wish that I, your son, should go to Europe and meet its kings and draw closer to them. You could not fail to have heard the news that on these occasions Ethiopia was greatly honored and that Your Majesty's name was much praised. I express the hope that henceforth Ethiopia, in educating and civilizing her sons, will attain as high a level as she had in her past. I have to inform you that the kings and presidents of Europe have requested that I should present to Your Majesty their greetings, coupled with their gratitude. After this, the Tetzhafe Tezas, on behalf of Her Majesty the Queen, read the following speech. O Crown Prince, my son, we took leave of each other with grief and tears when you left to meet the kings of Europe for the sake of the prosperity of our country and the benefit of our people. But now that you have returned safely and I have seen your face, I present thanks to God. Let this day be blessed. Although our country, Ethiopia, is ancient, it is true that she remained distant from the kings of foreign countries because for much of the time she was surrounded by pagans. But later, when my father Menelik II had concluded the conquest and pacification of the surrounding territories, which his fathers had already initiated, he intended to draw closer to foreign governments. He therefore selected your father, Ras Makonnen, from among the princes and nobles, and sent him to countries which he did not know. Rasmakonnen established friendly relations with their kings, carried out the wishes of Menelik II, and then returned home. And you, my trusted son, went, like your father, to countries you did not know, and patiently endured the turbulence of the sea and the heat of the sun, carrying out the plan which we had devised for the prosperity of our country and the good fortune of our people. You extended the friendship and affection of kings which has existed of old, and now I am very pleased about your return after carrying out my wishes. Ethiopia presents her joyful thanks to God. Praise be to God for all of you, princes and nobles who traveled together, have now safely returned without any one of you missing. He concluded by saying, I beg of our Creator that henceforth he should assist you to think about and to preserve in everything that is proper for the benefit of our people and for the prosperity of our country, as indeed you have witnessed abroad. After this, we went to our home and as well found all our family safe and well. We presented thanks to God. Chapter 22. About the Convention for Mutual Assistance between the British Government as regards the barrage at Lake Tana and the Italian Government as regards the construction of a railway from the border of Eritrea cutting through the middle of Ethiopia to Italian Somaliland. The British Government in 1895, which is to say 1902, dispatched Lieutenant Colonel John Lane Harrington as a special envoy. And in accord between the British Sudan government and Emperor Menelik, it was agreed that the Ethiopian government would not permit obstructing the flow of the Sobat River and other small rivers entering the Abay, i.e. Blue Nile. Because Emperor Menelik had approved this accord, the envoy had given written assurance, by letter only, to the effect that the British Sudan government would pay the Ethiopian government annually 10,000 guineas. And subsequently, they said, may permission be granted to us to regulate the flow of the rivers of the waters by building a barrage at Lake Tana, for the waters of the Nile are low in the summer and plentiful in the winter. Once permission had been granted to them, they promised to send engineers, lest the waters, having increased with the building of the Lake Tana barrage, should perhaps drown the islands and the churches situated in Lake Tana. They would then present a report to the Ethiopian government, and the engineers were indeed sent in 1899, which is to say 1906. Subsequently, after the Great War in 1912, which is to say 1919, the Italian government dispatched envoys to London and presented a proposal for mutual assistance in connection with the British government's Lake Tana Dam and the Italian government's construction of a railway from the border of Eritrea and cutting through the center of Ethiopia. But as the British government had begun to negotiate direct with the Ethiopian government, the proposals which the Italian government had presented to it remained for the time being unacceptable. Later on, in 1916, that's to say 1924, when we came to London as guests of His Majesty King George V, we had discussions at an interview with Mr. Macdonald, the Prime Minister, in order to conclude negotiations over some matters of concern to both governments. When the Prime Minister presented to us a request to the effect that he would welcome it if we allowed that Lake Tana Dam scheme to be carried out, which the British Sudan government had previously initiated, we explained to him our proposal that once we had ourselves caused the Lake Tana Dam to be constructed by well-known engineers, it seemed to us a good thing if we were to lease it to Britain, embodying it in a treaty in which the interests of both governments would be firmly safeguarded. When Mr. Macdonald said, it is our pleasure to accept this proposal of yours, provided you inform us in advance from which country you will appoint the engineers and allow us to make the choice. Adding at once, won't you appoint engineers from the United States of America? We accepted with pleasure and agreed orally on the main matters. And a few weeks later, we confirmed this to him in writing. But when the Italian government heard of the decision as regards the Lake Tana Dam, after direct discussions between the British government and ourselves, it pressed the British government once again in 1918, which is to say 1925, not to lose sight of the proposal that the British government should assist the Italians to build a railway from the border of Eritrea cutting through the middle of Ethiopia up to Italian Somaliland, and as a result, the Italian government negotiated and agreed with the British government at Rome that the proposal, which it had previously initiated in 1912, that's to say 1919, be implemented. An exchange of correspondence ensued which embodied the text of the agreement. The two governments arranged for the text of the agreement, though allegedly only an exchange of correspondence, to be registered with the League of Nations at Geneva. While they did this, they did not inform, even by a single word, the sovereign Ethiopian government. The following is the text of the letters of agreement which were exchanged. Sir Ronald Graham to M. Mussolini, Rome, 20th December, 1925. Your Excellency cannot fail to be aware of the very great benefit for Egypt and the Sudan in preventing an interruption in the flow of the water, and indeed in bringing about an increase in the flow as far as possible, because the water from the White and Blue Niles and their tributary streams is necessary for irrigation. Various proposals which had previously been decided upon with this end in view are now being carried out. The others are being given consideration. Your Excellency is aware of the talks which the British government had initiated at Addis Ababa in view of its fiduciary responsibility for Egypt and the Sudan, and mindful in this respect of the value of Egypt. The basis of the discussions is to collect the waters by building a dam under concession from the Ethiopian government at Lake Tana and its shore, and to supply the water to the White Nile. Up to now, these talks have remained without any result. In November 1919, which is Hidar 1912, when Italian envoys were in London, they had presented an offer of help which the Italian government would extend in regard to this matter in the following terms. When the British government, mindful of the great value of the waters of Lake Tana, requests a concession from the Ethiopian government for the construction of a barrage at Lake Tana, in the part given over to Italian interest, the Italian government will support Great Britain. This is pending the delimitation of the zone given over to British interest and pending a full investigation of the reservation which Italy requires under the terms of the tripartite agreement. When the British government asked the Ethiopian government for a concession to construct a motor road from Lake Tana to the Sudan, it may request the Italian government to support it. This railway, according to the tripartite agreement, will pass to the west of Addis Ababa. All the works necessary for the construction of this railway shall have a free passage across the above-mentioned motor road. Italy requests Britain to support with the Ethiopian government all requests which she may submit for exclusive economic rights in the west of Ethiopia and in the territory through which the aforementioned railway will pass, and for obtaining economic concessions in the Italian zone. She reserves the right to present the identical request to France. The above proposal was not found acceptable at that time. The chief reason was that a strong objection arose against any one foreign government whatsoever controlling the source of the rivers so vital to the prosperity of Egypt and the Sudan, and indeed to their very life. But by virtue of the fortunate existence of mutual trust between our two governments, His Majesty's government desired to apply this to other matters as well. Therefore, HBM's government have examined the problem once more. The British government is convinced that the proposal which Italy has submitted does not conflict with the provisions of the agreement concluded in London on 13th December 1906, which is to say 4th Tahasas 1899. Since its objective was to maintain the status quo in Ethiopia on the basis of the international treaties noted in Article 1 of the agreement, as well as to protect the respective interests of the signatory governments lest they should suffer damage on their part. Consequently, HBM's government would welcome the offer of support made by Italy, provided there remain unaffected the waters in which Egypt and the Sudan
have such an interest, and which the Ethiopian government has long recognized. Therefore, I have the honor to request Your Excellency, on behalf of His Majesty's Principal Secretary, the State of Foreign Affairs, to support and to assist the request with the Ethiopian government at Addis Ababa to grant a concession and to permit HBM's government to construct and to maintain a motor road on which to transport equipment and personnel and the like from the Sudan border up to the barrage. In return for this, HBM's government are prepared to support the request which the Italian government will submit to the Ethiopian government to obtain a concession to build and to extend a railway from Eritrea to the frontier of Italian Somaliland. This railway, as well as all the operations necessary to construct and to extend it, may cross freely the above-mentioned motor road. Therefore, in order that both the British and the Italian governments should simultaneously obtain the concessions which they are seeking as regards Lake Tana and the railway link from Eritrea to Italian Somaliland, it is necessary that that identical instructions be dispatched to the British and Italian representatives in Ethiopia, that they should collaborate and consult together. If one of the two governments obtains the concession it seeks and the other remains unsuccessful, the government which has obtained its aims would unceasingly strive with all vigor that the other should likewise succeed. If HBM's government, with the valued assistance of the Italian government, obtain the desired Lake Tana concession, then they are prepared to recognize that Italy shall be the economic beneficiary in Western Ethiopia and the aforementioned area. Furthermore, since HBM's government undertake to support all Italian requests to obtain economic concessions in the above mentioned zone, the Italian government on its part, while recognizing the hydraulic rights which Egypt and the Sudan possess, enters into an obligation not to construct a dam upon the sources of the White and Blue Niles, or on the sources of their tributaries, nor to carry out any work that would impede or diminish the flow of the waters into the main river. Notwithstanding this, the inhabitants in those regions may utilize the water, construct pools to collect the water, receive anything from drinking or agriculture or food crops for the local inhabitants, construct dams for hydroelectric power, or utilize the waters in minor tributaries. HBM's government take this opportunity of assuring the Italian government that the Lake Tana barrage and the hydraulic work will be carried out as far as possible with locally recruited labor, and that the collection of the water by the barrage will not exceed the amount collected hitherto into the lake. During the rainy season, HBM's government are therefore convinced that the construction of this dam, quite apart from being of benefit to Egypt and the Sudan, will also increase the prosperity of the region and will progressively help to enrich economically the local inhabitants. Signed, R. Graham, Rome, 20th December 1925, that's to say 11th Tejasas, 1918. To H.E., the special envoy, Sir R. Graham. I received and attentively studied the letter which Your Excellency, under instruction from your government, wrote to me on 5th Tejasas, 14th December 1925, concerning the irrigation of Egypt and the Sudan, as well as the matter which has remained hitherto unaccomplished owing to inertia on the part of the Ethiopian government, i.e. to cause a fuller flow of the Blue Nile by the construction of a barrage on Lake Tana. Your Excellency is not unaware of the proposals which the Italian envoys presented in London in November 1919, Hidar 1912, for a friendly Anglo-Italian cooperation in regard to this, but these remained unacceptable at that time because they raised concern over permitting a foreign power to exercise control over rivers and sources so very essential to the prosperity of Egypt and the Sudan, and indeed even to their very existence. Your Excellency further informs me that HBM's government, after studying this request more profoundly, accept that there is nothing in the Italian proposal which contradicts the agreement concluded in London on 13th December 1906, 4th Tejasas, 1899, under which the signatory governments are agreed to maintain the status quo in Ethiopia without abandoning the basis of international law as indicated in Article 1 of the Accord, and to protect their respective interests. For this reason, the British government, adhering to the Italian proposals, accept Italian support with pleasure. This support in no way affects the existing principal hydraulic interest of Egypt and the Sudan, which the Italian government itself has recognized. Thus, Your Excellency, upon instructions from your government, request that the Italian government should assist and support the British government in its demand of the Ethiopian government to construct a barrage upon Lake Tana and a motor road from the Sudan border to the dam for the transport of food, equipment, workmen, and all similar things. Your Excellency informs me that, in exchange for this action by the Italian government, the British government, in its turn, will assist the Italian government with its request, the Ethiopian government, for an extension for its own benefit of the railway from the frontier of Eritrea to that of Italian Somaliland, as well as for a treaty which provides for free transit across the aforementioned motor road for everything needed for the construction of the railway and its proper use. With this end in view, the necessary identical instructions have been transmitted to the British and Italian representatives in Ethiopia. Your Excellency informs me that it is essential that the British and Italian governments should undertake to request the Ethiopian government upon the matter on which they are both agreed, i.e. as regards Lake Tana and the railway linking Eritrea and Italian Somaliland. In case one government obtains the concession it seeks while the other fails to do so, the successful government shall extend all possible help without relaxing its efforts to the unsuccessful one until it likewise achieves its purpose. Furthermore, Your Excellency informs me that if HBM's government is able to obtain, with the assistance of the Italian government, the concession which it seeks from the Ethiopian government as regards Lake Tana, the British government on its part will then recognize Italy's special economic influence in western Ethiopia and in the entire area which the aforementioned railway traverses. In addition, the British government will support every request which the Italian government makes in the aforementioned zone as regards economic concessions. Nonetheless, this agreement and negotiation will come into force only on the understanding that the Italian government, while recognizing the long-standing assignment of waters to the Sudan, will enter into an obligation not to construct on the sources of the Blue and White Niles and their tributaries any kind of work that might impede their flow into the main river. Your Excellency informs me that, notwithstanding any of the conditions outlined above, the local inhabitants may make use of the waters to a reasonable extent for anything required for drinking, domestic needs, or agriculture, as well as storing water for harnessing electric power or similar essential purposes. Furthermore, Your Excellency, upon instructions received from you, from your government, informs the Italian government that for the construction of the barrage and the road, the labor employed will, as far as possible, be locally recruited, and that the level of the lake will not be allowed to exceed the previous maximum attained during the rainy season. Finally, the British government is convinced that the construction of this dam will be beneficial not only for Egypt and the Sudan, but will bring prosperity and economic development to the people of the region. In reply to the above clarifications and requests which Your Excellency has made to me, and since the British government recognizes it now being opportune to extend to the aforementioned question the principle of friendly cooperation which has become so precious in all other areas, I would inform Your Excellency that, while the royal government is very happy to accept the proposals, I consider that this agreement will be the more useful the more widely applied it is. The royal Italian government considers it firmly established that HBM's government is now convinced that the Italian proposals presented in November 1919, Hidar 1912, do not contradict the wording of the agreement reached in London on 13th December 1906, 4th Taxas 1899, as indeed Italy has always firmly maintained, it being the main aim of these proposals to maintain the status quo in Ethiopia on the basis of international instruments embodied in Article 1 of the agreement, while the signatory governments were collaborating lest anything should adversely affect their respective interests. This being so, although the proposals presented in London in November 1912 and outlined above are reckoned to be part of a wider agreement of a colonial nature deriving from the treaty signed in London in December 1906, and although there were only a few points of this agreement that were been effectively carried out, the Royal Italian government is willing to raise the matter once again, particularly since the British government desires to apply the principle of friendly cooperation, a desire which Italy shares. Furthermore, we are hoping that the interest of Britain and Italy in Ethiopia will be properly developed and protected without transgressing the treaty concluded in London in December 1906, a treaty which forms the basis of this agreement. To this end, the Italian government will assist the British government when it requests a concession to construct a barrage at Lake Tana and motor road from the Sudan frontier to the dam for the transport of food and equipment. Furthermore, the Italian government takes firm note of the offer of help by the British government as regards the former's request of the Ethiopian government to extend the railway from the frontier of Eritrea to Italian Somaliland and to build stations, as well as to obtain free transit for everything required for the construction of this railway across aforementioned motor road. To this end, the Italian government will transmit the necessary instructions to its representative at Addis Ababa, coinciding with the instructions given to its representative by the British government, so that the concessions which the British and Italian governments are seeking as regards Lake Tana and the rail link between Eritrea and Italian Somaliland be granted to them both together. In case one government obtains the concession it seeks while the other fails to do so, the successful one shall press its assistance unceasingly until the other achieves satisfaction, so that both obtain their concessions together, if at all possible. If HBM's government succeeds in obtaining, with the aid of the Italian government, the concession regarding Lake Tana which it seeks from the Ethiopian government, Britain will likewise recognize Italian economic preponderance in Western Ethiopia and in the above-mentioned area which the railway traverses. She will also support the Italian government in all its requests of the Ethiopian government as regards concessions in the aforementioned zone. The Italian government, on its part, recognizing the long-established hydraulic rights of Egypt and the Sudan, enters into an obligation not to construct any work on the sources of the White and Blue Niles and their tributaries that they might impede the flow into the main river. As regards hydraulic interest, I am confident that the British government has the firm intention to respect the long-established state of affairs of the people resident in the adjacent territories reckoned to be within the sphere of special Italian influence. This project, to the utmost possible extent and as far as can be reconciled with the principal interest of Egypt and the Sudan, shall be carried out on the basis of the utmost possible satisfaction of the economic requirements of these local populations. Please accept my respectful greetings. Signed, Mussolini. When the British and Italian ministers at Addis Ababa, according to the instructions which they had received from their respective governments concerning this matter, presented to us jointly the text of the pact about which the two governments had reached agreement, we were astonished at this and wrote them as follows. To Farai Mekonnen, Crown Prince of Ethiopia and Regent Plenipotentiary, to H.E. Mr. Charles Bentinck, British Minister Plenipotentiary. Please, peace be with you. The letter which you wrote me on 2nd Sinai, 9th June 1926, has reached me. This letter is wholly identical with the missive which H.E. Count Colli, the Italian minister, has addressed to me. It informs me of the agreement between the two of you that the Ethiopian government should grant you concessions, i.e. for the damming of Lake Tana by the British and for the construction of a railway in Ethiopia by Italy. The fact that both of you have reached agreement and that you have considered it proper jointly to inform us of this agreement in identical notes raises some disquieting thoughts in us, and therefore we shall now, first of all, have to take counsel about this. To this end, it is right to place the matter before the League of Nations, as it requires to be carefully examined in the first place. 8th Sane 1918, which is to say 15th June 1926. A note in the same vein was written to the Italian minister. Subsequently, we wrote the following appeal and presented it to the Secretary General of the League of Nations, M. Avenal. Our government has recently received identical notes written by both the British and Italian governments informing us of their agreement for Britain to dam Lake Tana and for Italy to construct a railway traversing Ethiopia. We are greatly distressed about this agreement being concluded by the two governments among themselves alone, without informing us, and then simply sending us joint notifications. When originally we were granted admission to the League of Nations, we were told that all governments of the world were reckoned as equal, that the independence of all would be respected, and that the ultimate aim of the League was to extend all and to strengthen peace among men in accordance with God's will. It did not seem to us proper to allow some members of the League of Nations to conclude an agreement among themselves and to force another member to accept their plan, even if it did not affect the national interest of that member. Secondly, it is the case that on one of the subjects among those on which they, Britain and Italy, have reached agreement, the Ethiopian and British governments have previously held discussions. No definite answer had been given because the matter under discussion had remained inconclusive and because we were still deliberating about it. Having agreed among themselves to hold discussions about this subject, they informed us in joint notes of this, their agreement. But the reason that we did not hurry to carry out what they were demanding of us, without giving it due reflection and without knowing whether it agreed with our people's needs, is that we cannot help considering the proposals as highly disturbing. Our people are desirous to do right. It is our constant wish to lead them on the road of civilization and improvement, but what they know of their history is that among the foreigners, these are few who do not desire to violate their frontiers and to impair their freedom. With God's goodness and the bravery of our soldiers, we have always, whatever the circumstances, been able to remain upon our mountain proud in our independence. Therefore, when foreigners who wish to establish themselves allegedly for economic reasons in our country or in our frontier areas contiguous to their possessions apply for permission to do so, we have to be very careful that they do not have political aims, and the recent quite unexpected agreement reached by them and the proposals they presented serve perhaps as the best proof of all that such caution is justified. Time has not yet permitted us to get accustomed so quickly to entirely new conditions and such like, for though our past history is glorious, it is not to be forgotten that it is only very recently that we have begun to follow the path of modern civilization. Even creation itself was not created all at once, and where is the country that has changed all its works within 1 year? If the countries whose geographical position has enabled them to outdistance us were to give us friendly advice and the necessary time, then, with our genuine eagerness, Ethiopia would go on improving uninterruptedly to attain a higher level in future, just as she had always done in the past. But to make undue haste may bring the danger of accidents. We should wish to know whether members of the League of Nations desire means of coercion to be used against us, which they would undoubtedly dislike if applied against themselves. I have the honor to inform all the honorable governments who are members of the League of Nations of those notifications which we have received, so that they be apprised of the fact that the proposals are incompatible with our country's independence, in particular when it is stated that a part of our possessions is to be given over to the economic influence of a certain great power, since we are aware that economic and political influence are closely bound up together. It is our duty to present a strong protest because, in our opinion, this agreement is incompatible with the basic idea of the League of Nations. Addis Ababa, 12th Sane, 1918. That's to say 19th June, 1926. After this note of appeal of ours had reached the League of Nations and the subject had been studied, the text of the request was sent to the two governments concerned. And subsequently, the British government replied as follows. London, 3rd August 1926, which is to say 27th Hamley, 1918. To the Secretary General of the League of Nations, on behalf of HBM's Principal Secretary of State for Foreign Affairs, I have received a copy of the note which the Imperial Ethiopian Crown Prince Tafari Makonnen addressed to Sir Eric Drummond, as well as your own respected letter of 15th Hamley, that is to say 22nd July, relating to the protest submitted by His Imperial Highness as regards the agreement between the British and Italian governments of December 1925, which is Tahsas 1918, by which the two governments contracted to assist each other when seeking the permission of the Ethiopian government for certain kinds of work as specified in those notes. 2. Although the British and Italian ministers at Addis Ababa had given assurances to the Ethiopian government when they presented the notes about which Britain and Italy had agreed, HBM's government regret that the correct version of these notes appears to have been misinterpreted and that intentions appear to have been attributed to the two governments which they did not, in fact, entertain. According to the text of the Ethiopian protest, it would appear that the British and Italian governments, having put their signatures to a treaty, are intent upon forcing their proposals on a member of the League, although these proposals are incompatible with its interest. They, the Ethiopians, have requested members of the League to state whether it is right that pressure should be exerted upon Ethiopia, which they would undoubtedly find unacceptable if applied to themselves. 3. There is nothing at all in the British and Italian notes that might suggest pressure or coercion against the Ethiopian government. In fact, this agreement as such, Sir Austen Chamberlain has stated in Parliament, was never designed to apply pressure against the Ethiopian government. In his opinion, the agreement as it stood was in the interest of all three governments. But, he added, the Ethiopian government were perfectly entitled to be the judge of Ethiopia's best interest. His Majesty's Charge d'Affaires had telegraphic instructions transmitted to him in July to inform the heir to the throne, Tafari, of this statement. 4. I refer in the following to the suggestion which has been made that the British and Italian governments desire to force the Ethiopian government to answer in haste the request made to it, without affording it the time to consider the interest of its people. In fact, however, Emperor Menelik confirmed in writing the following statement, which he had made orally a few days earlier, and which is embodied in notes exchanged between the British minister at Addis Ababa and the Ethiopian government on 18th May 1902, which is to say 8th Gembot 1894, that there shall not be carried out, without consulting the British and the Sudan governments, any sort of work that may affect the flow of the waters of the Blue Nile and of Lake Tana. But if any work of this kind were planned, all other obligations being equal, preference shall be given to the proposal presented by HBM's government and the Sudan government. His Imperial Majesty Emperor Menelik has no intention of giving any concessions with regard to the Blue Nile and Lake Tana to anyone except to HBM's government or to a subject of either government. Since this undertaking proves that Emperor Menelik II had given permission 24 years ago for the British government to construct a barrage at Lake Tana, It is now possible to examine, with the permission and help of the Ethiopian government, the specific proposals and their realization as regards this project, which had been submitted by the British government on many suitable occasions. And it has become possible to assess the position properly ever since the engineering experts who had been dispatched to Lake Tana have returned with their detailed findings. It does not, therefore, seem equitable to charge HBM's government with acting in undue haste as regards the Lake Tana project. 5. In the concluding parts of its protest, the Ethiopian government asked whether the Anglo-Italian note affects Ethiopia's independence, especially when it is stipulated that a part of Ethiopia shall be surrendered to the economic influence of a great power. In particular, Sir Austin Chamberlain desires to make it known emphatically that the Anglo-Italian note does not state that we shall retain a part of Ethiopia for Italian economic influence. It is true that HBM's government, for their own purposes, and Italy under her treaty obligations, recognize Italy's special economic influence in western Ethiopia and in the entire territory which the aforementioned railway traverses, joining Eritrea and Italian Somaliland. But this undertaking does not impose an obligation of anything affecting the dispositions of the three governments. Just because the British government has engaged not to do or support doing anything in competition with Italy in the area specified in return for Italian assurances as regards Lake Tana. 6. Sir Austin Chamberlain will be able to submit once again the assurances and proofs which he has given to Ethiopia so as to enable the League Council to examine at its forthcoming session the note which the Ethiopian government has sent to you. Signed, John Murray. 4 days after the British government had sent the above statement to the League of Nations, the Italian government wrote as follows. Rome, 7th August 1926, 1st Nahasi, 1918. I am instructed by the head of the government and Minister for Foreign Affairs to inform you of the receipt of your letter of 15 Hamle, 22nd July, last together with the copy and enclosures of the protest addressed to you by Rastafari Makonnen, heir to the throne of Ethiopia, as regards the agreement reached by the British and Italian governments in December 1925, Tahsas 1918, to render assistance to each other in requesting the Ethiopian government to carry out certain works in Ethiopia. The Royal Italian government greatly regrets to observe that the Ethiopian government has not properly understood the thinking embodied in the Anglo-Italian agreement, as is indeed shown by the substance of the note which Tafari Makonnen, heir of the throne of Ethiopia, sent to the members of the League of Nations. Moreover, what has caused surprise to the Royal Italian government is the fact that only a short time ago, the Italian representative at Addis Ababa had fully explained to the Ethiopian government the scope of the matter in question, pointing out the limited object of the discussions between the two governments with a view to coordinating some of the economic interests of Britain and Italy. The Italian envoy also made it clear that the realization of the project depended on the wishes of the Ethiopian government, whether it contributed to the economic development of the country, and whether it was in conformity with Ethiopia's best interest. Following these explanations, the heir to the throne of Ethiopia, Tafari Makonnen, wrote a letter dated 12th Sunday, 19th June, to the Italian minister at Addis Ababa. In this letter, he thanked the head of the Italian government for the assurances given to him and said he did not doubt Italy's sentiments of friendship and her willingness to honor Ethiopia's independence. The Italian government considers that there is nothing at all that could justify the fears of the Ethiopian government that the British and Italian governments are planning. In the note of agreement in question, any acts of coercion or precipitate pressure against Ethiopia. Furthermore, the friendly and explicit assurances previously given to the Ethiopian government by Italy should have sufficed to convince Ethiopia that there is nothing to bring about such apprehensions. The treaty in question, as regards the cession of economic influence to Italy in certain regions of Ethiopia, having been undertaken specifically by the British government, is binding solely on the British and Italian governments, but does not affect the powers of Ethiopia, nor does it limit any future action of disposition by the three governments. The agreement is a kind of economic guarantee that the work initiated by Italian young men shall be well accomplished, and that the resources found in Ethiopia be developed and exploited without competition with British enterprises. Signed, Grandi. After we had seen the text of the replies which these two governments had made to the inquiries transmitted to us through the League of Nations, we wrote once more as follows. To the Secretary General of the League of Nations, peace be with you. In a letter which I wrote to you on 12th Sunday, 19th June, I had requested you to communicate on our behalf to the members of the League of Nations the protest which it had seen proper to the Imperial Ethiopian government to submit as regards the agreement which the British and Italian governments had reached on 5th and 11th of Taxas 1918, which is to say 14th and 20th December 1925, with a view to exploiting their interest in Ethiopia. The Imperial Ethiopian government was very properly distressed upon learning of the agreement which these two great powers had reached, to act as they desire towards a friendly government which, like them, is a member of the League of Nations, without first requesting the permission of that country. If the Ethiopian government were to fail to accept, after due examination, that this convention was in the best interest of Ethiopia, it considers that these two powers would certainly exert pressure to obtain the economic conditions they had requested. This being so, it was possible to assert with regard to present events that the Anglo-Italian accord was not compatible, at any rate indirectly, with the covenant of the League of Nations, since the British and Italian governments, like all the remaining members of the League, had undertaken not to touch the age-old independence of Ethiopia or to violate her territorial integrity. According to our opinion, under Article 20th of the covenant, it was incumbent upon them not to enter into such an accord, but as it seemed to us that they planned to violate that article, the object of their agreement could have no validity with regard to us and must therefore be reckoned null and void. If the two great powers, on their part, had not officially notified us on the same day, they would not have aroused our anxiety. This joint notification which they presented appeared to us to reveal the first sign of coercion. From then onwards, while the two great powers were exhibiting their friendly intentions, when replying to our protest, they began to strive hard to allay apprehensions over the Ethiopian appeal. Furthermore, the British government took the opportunity with regard to this matter of informing us of the explanatory statement which H.E. Sir Austen Chamberlain had made in Parliament. He announced clearly, the two governments have no intentions of making economic demands upon the country, and there is nothing in their agreement that could be binding upon the Ethiopian government. There is no plan to coerce the Ethiopian government, and it is indeed the government of Ethiopia that must be the judge of Ethiopia's best interest. The Italian government notified us in a similar vein. Apart from this, the British government announced that the two great powers intended to deposit the terms of their accord with the Secretariat of the League of Nations, and the Imperial Ethiopian government has learned that registration has since taken place. As we are aware that registration in accordance with Article 18 of the Covenant is for information only, the Imperial government does not consider it necessary to submit a protest about the implementation of this requirement. But since the Imperial government intended to fulfill the obligations embodied in the covenant and to establish relations with the nations of the world based on the justice and honor, it seemed to us proper and in accordance with the rules to request your assistance in the publication of this letter. together with the said notes, as well as the reassuring replies to our protest, so that everybody may be aware of the position taken by the imperial government. This being so, the members of the League of Nations will not then entertain any doubt that the Ethiopian government has any treaty obligation whatever towards the two governments which have earlier declared an interest in the matter, and that it possesses full powers, as indeed the British and Italian governments themselves have stated, either to accept or to reject any request made to it, and that, finally, the imperial government is the sole judge of what is in Ethiopia's best interest. Addis Ababa, 30th, Nahasi, 1918, which is to say 4th December, 1926. As we thought that this affair of the two governments reaching agreement by themselves without any information being proferred to the Ethiopian government had been disposed of by the League of Nations, we did not consider that the discussions we had held with Mr. MacDonald in 1916, which is to say 1924, should remain unconcluded. We therefore dispatched in 1920, that's to say 1928, Azaz Werkna, whom we had now appointed as Ethiopian minister in London, as special envoy to the U.S. A. We arranged that he should return after discussions with the internationally renowned White Engineering Company about the demanding of damming of Lake Tana. We also arranged that he should discuss this at meetings in Addis Ababa with representatives of the British government. After they had departed following these negotiations, the White Engineering Company, on their part, sent in 1923, that's to say 1930, a number of engineers who surveyed Lake Tana and then returned. Later, engineers of the British, Sudan, and Egyptian governments came together to Addis Ababa, and after we had held extensive discussion about the matter, they made an appointment to meet once more at Addis Ababa in 1927, that's to say 1935, to draft the details of the contract. They then went back, but when at the first time of the appointment, we were preparing to transmit a telegram to summon the representatives of the White Engineering Company, the British minister, and the Egyptian consul at Addis Ababa let us know that their representatives had deferred their visit to Addis Ababa for the time being. They did not, for the moment, reveal to us the reason for this action, but the wall disturbances had started, and we reckoned that this was the reason. We notified the White Engineering Company not to send their representatives to Addis Ababa, but the Ethiopian government had earlier given an undertaking to the effect that it would not cut off the flow of the small rivers entering the Blue Nile, nor that of the River Sobat, without the agreement of the British Sudan government, and therefore the British Sudan government was to pay to the Ethiopian government an annual sum of 10,000 guineas. When we noticed in our records the non-payment to the Ethiopian government of this money by the British Sudan government ever since the said treaty had been signed and letters were exchanged from 1895, that's to say 1902, until 1924, that's to say 1931, we wrote to the British minister at Addis Ababa asking that the money be paid in accordance with the terms of the letter. He claimed that this money was to be paid when permission to dam Lake Tana had been granted, and while he brought up various other excuses and we were engaged in protracted correspondence, Italy meanwhile unleashed a war of aggression against us, and that matter, therefore, remained in abeyance. Furthermore, we had not neglected the interest of the Italian government by possibly using as a pretext the direct negotiations with the British government concerning the damming of Lake Tana, and when the former asked for permission to build a motor road from Assab to Desi and to expand trade, we raised no difficulties whatsoever, but accorded them permission in a spirit of friendship. Details of all this will be found presently in connection with the ceremonial welcome which we prepared when His Highness the Duke of Abruzzi came to Addis Ababa to return our visit.